Good afternoon. I'd like to call the Design Review Committee meeting to order for October the 18th. I'd like to welcome everybody. The Design Review Committee is a subcommittee of Historic Zoning Commission. The meeting is informal and designed to guide applicants through the process of obtaining a certificate of appropriateness or COA for projects within the city's historic districts in light of the historic district design guidelines. Applicant participation in DRC meetings is voluntary but highly recommended. Changes made or suggestions taken by the applicant based on discussions with the DRC are the applicant's choice, but the DRC makes no representation as to whether any changes or suggestions made during the meeting will be approved by the voting body, which is the Historic Zoning Commission. There are 10 items on the agenda this afternoon. The last item that we had previous was pulled by the applicant. And we have a break that's built into this after item number 5. When your item's called, please introduce yourself and generally describe your item in about 3 to 5 minutes. Please focus on the specific points of your project that you want the DRC to discuss. And we have time limits that we've got on each of these items today. All of them except the first one will be about 15 minutes. With the first one, we've allowed about 30 minutes for discussion and questions. So with that, our first item is discussion of the Franklin Grove plan use development program, including site features, new construction, parking area, drive aisles located at 423 South Margin. The Heritage Foundation of Williamson County is the applicant.
Mr. Chair, I'll be stepping away from this item as I have a potential conflict of interest as a nearby property owner.
Thank fine.
Mr. Chair, for just full disclosure, I worked there for 31 years, so.
Thank you. And I'd like to thank Cheryl Studert for leading us on that site visit. I think you're items that you highlighted were very informative and helped us greatly, so thank you. And I guess at this time, Amanda, do you have any opening comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I too want to thank the applicant for hosting the city and the interested public in the site visit at 3 o'clock. I want to remind everyone that we do have some slide presentations that the applicant would like to further use to explain and to help reinforce the ideas that he relayed during the 3 p.m. meeting. After he speaks, staff will provide some comments, and then it will be open to committee member discussion. Again, public comment will be reserved for the Historic Zoning Commission meeting. Thank you.
Cheryl?
I know that you have a very long meeting, so, and we've just spent 45 minutes on the site, so I won't take you through a lot. We did submit our full application before the last DRC meeting, so you've been able to see that project. It's unchanged since that time, and we heard your comments then, and we look forward to hearing your comments tonight. We're specifically interested, we'd like to get that schoolhouse located, and of course there are other things on the site that I'm sure that you noticed. So, but I think question and answers would probably be more expeditious than me going through a lengthy presentation.
Okay, thank you. Amanda?
I would prefer if the applicant could just briefly explain the screen here, as I think it'll be particularly helpful for some of the comments that were received during the last Design Review Committee meeting from the committee members themselves as to where each building is situated in relation to surrounding properties.
Sure. I'll be glad to do that. Looking at the screen, we are proposing...
Wait just a minute. Susan?
Amanda, could you enlarge that plan?
Sure. I want to be able to show neighboring properties as requested. So please let me know if you need me to pan in, zoom out, et cetera.
And this plan has been updated as you requested to show the adjacent properties as shown on the GIS map that the county has. We're showing the entrance off Lewisburg, which is diagonally to the left. Margin is at the top of the screen going off diagonally to the right. We are showing the entrance there on Lewisburg, close to where the existing entrance is. We've outlined the new with stakes. As you pull into that entrance, there is a parking lot on the right, which is a bit unusual. What we are showing there is that it's convenient parking, it's ADA parking, but it also, because of the grade change between Lewisburg and that parking, is significantly higher. There is an existing stone wall along Lewisburg, and we would put heavy landscaping in there so that parking would really not be visible for the neighbors or from Lewisburg. So that parking is located to the right. Immediately adjacent to that is the current Lehue Mansion. That is the Entrepreneur Innovation Center, a joint venture with Williamson Inc. And it is fronting onto the drive aisle and a roundabout. So the two-way traffic would come in off Lewisburg, be able to drop off at the roundabout, and then exit the site from that point, or be able to continue around the site to additional parking or other buildings. The primary focus is the Winstead House, which will be the Robert Moore Museum of Art. It is the building right there in the center of the property. It is the flagship of this property. It will be an art museum. And we plan a few changes to that, primarily in the back where there were additions that were added over the years that we think can be taken back to a more interpretive situation with the original project, the original building. We do have an elevator to put in there, a fire stair. We're planning on putting those within the existing construction and not adding on for those. The building that's up toward the left corner of the site, the white building, is the schoolhouse. We have relocated that schoolhouse from where we looked at before, down closer to the intersection, to bring it up further away from that intersection and give you some more space in there. We have it staked on the site, which you saw a few minutes ago, and that's the location we're proposing. The unusual thing about that, for anybody that didn't hear it, is that the Rosenwald schools were about 5,000 of those built all the way from Texas up into Virginia, and they were directed to be oriented by the specifications of the Rosenwald Foundation to be pointed directly oriented north. There are some exceptions, but they were almost always either north or south, and that was to provide ample light for the students on the inside. The existing school is located directly to the north, and we are proposing locating this directly to the north. That does not line up either with Margin or Lewisburg, but opens into a garden that we're proposing to be a lawn area that you can see there just above where the schoolhouse is. That would be more of a schoolhouse type lawn, which is more indicative of what it would have been at the time. We think that it was always a journey to get to those schools. They were not located in urban areas right on Main Street. And so we want this to be a journey as well, so that when school children are dropped off for the Heritage Classroom or other programs, or adults come to it, that there is a meandering walk to get to it, sort of a journey that you take to get there. It will be handicap accessible, as will the schoolhouse. As you move around the site, you move around toward the back, at the bottom of the site is the conservatory. It is a building that is designed to be a venue. It's surrounded on three sides by support spaces that include catering kitchen, and dressing room, that kind of thing, to try to keep the noise on the inside. It'll be robustly built with a high sound transmission coefficients to prevent noise from going out in the neighbors. The only openings onto that, with the exception of a service door, are onto the garden that you see where the oak tree is toward the Winstead House. That will be a brick-walled garden, and all the activities will happen within that brick-walled garden. The venue itself, the three walls that abut the neighbors will be solid brick walls, well detailed, but also robustly built to contain any noise that might intrude on the neighbors. And then as you go around, we added a building for smaller venues. That was a summer house, and that summer house could seat up to 144 in lecture style seating for smaller venues. And that building is the approximate location where the two-story mansion building is now. Both the venue and the summer house are one-story venues. To give you an idea of the scale, the eave height of the Winstead Mansion is about 34 feet. The eave height of the venue in the back is 20 feet and 6 inches. So a much lower structure. It is truly, both these are one-story structures. As you go around the site, parking is located along that side in the approximate same location that it has been for 40 years at the Elmore School of Design. And you can see the gardens in the front, and there are also gardens all around. The other thing that we mentioned last time, and it is right almost in the middle of the site, if you draw a line between the Winstead House and the schoolhouse, there is a design there that you see that is the secret garden. It would be a walled garden for school children readings. It would be there for family gatherings and for times it's a smaller venue, but it would be an enclosed, brick enclosed garden with 8-foot walls around the outside. You can see coming up the center of the site is an axis that has walkways that go out toward margin from the front of Winstead. That approximates historic evidence that we found of either a walkway or drive that went up to the front door of the mansion from margin.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you for the opportunity to provide comment. I do think that the site visit was extremely helpful in better understanding the relationship of proposed buildings in relation to new ones and the neighboring properties. I do want to remind everyone that the role of the Historic Zoning Commission as part of this overall review process, which involves multiple elected and appointed bodies, is that the commission is charged with reviewing new construction from a placement standpoint and from design contextual elements that would potentially impact the existing site and setting or the neighboring site and setting as part of a historic district. The Historic Zoning Commission does not comment on use, and so in reviewing the proposal against the design guidelines, I think one of the questions that has come up pretty frequently is about the classification of any additional buildings on the site. So obviously there are two very significant historic principal structures currently on the site, number 4 here, I'm noting with my cursor, and then number 9. Those are the two mansions currently on the site. There's also a historic smokehouse, and there is also a proposal to relocate a historic structure onto the site, which is located at number 6. So the design guidelines would recommend that principal structures or the main use buildings on the site follow certain standards and that accessory structures, which are typically associated with outbuildings, with garages, with accessory dwellings, that they meet certain standards. Accessory structures are typically located in locations that are not highly visible from the street and are diminutive in use and size. Because the proposal is a development plan that envisions that there will be multiple uses on the site and the Historic Zoning Commission does not review use, I think the most appropriate way by which to review this would be to keep the existing historic structures in mind, namely the Winstead House and the building that is being identified as the Leahy Mansion, and that any new buildings would need to be diminutive to those buildings in scale, which would be stories, height, massing, which is generally width, but not always width. Massing is sort of a complicated term that can involve the type of material used, how heavy a building feels in relation to others, and where the buildings are located in relation to each other. So that could be setbacks from the property line or setbacks, like space between one building and another building. So with that in mind, the commission also reviews site features such as new drive aisles, new walkways, parking areas, and anything that could be consequential to the historic site and setting, which could in this case be the secret garden proposal or how the screening is proposed to be placed around the property, et cetera. So I, in the interest of time, I will not reiterate so much of the comments I made at the last ERC meeting, but to say that there are a lot of great intentional things on this proposal. I'm so excited to see that these historic buildings will be preserved and maintained. They are so important to the fabric of downtown Franklin, and I commend that Heritage Foundation greatly for wanting to take that on. There are some things, however, that I feel are not in keeping with the intent of the design guidelines. I'll start at the driveway. I do think that the parking area located in front of the historic buildings is in conflict with the design guidelines, which would recommend that parking areas be located behind the principal structures and to be screened as necessary. The applicant is proposing to screen those, so I would recommend that the historic zoning commissioners, upon receiving this application for a recommendation to the Planning Commission in the BOMA, find more information or seek more information about how this would be screened and how it would impact views from the South Margin or Lewisburg view sheds. I do feel that there is some consequence to adding a turnaround that comes so close to the historic structures. I'd like to see a little bit more space between them. Historically, as Mr. Stewart had noted, there was potentially a walkway that came up and not a significant drive aisle. I appreciate that the drive aisle is not in view sheds in front of the historic house, but it isn't in view sheds in front of this one. So to make it more diminutive and less hardscape coming so close to the building would be more ideal. The location of the relocated smokehouse from behind building number 4 to behind building number 9 is unfortunate in that it will effectively lessen view shed and public engagement with a historic feature on the site. We would like to see that historic structures are preserved and maintained in their original context and their original locations as much as possible. We do understand that this building was not located where it currently is located historically. And while we don't know exactly where it was proposed, it would have been a diminutive building. It would have been behind the principal structures, but I am not certain that hiding it behind the parking is the best bet. I would encourage the applicant, based on the intent of trying to highlight historic structures, to find a location that might be more appropriately suited with that in mind. I do think that the additions that are proposed to be removed from building 4 are appropriate. There are a number of additions that are not historic and frankly would not meet the intent of the current design guidelines if brought in today. So relocating or removing those and making some corrections and amending some of those to better meet the intent of our current guidelines is entirely appropriate. Again, we'll see more of that when at a later phase. If the application for a development plan is approved by the BOMA, we will see this before the site plan stage. The applicant, frankly, could come in now and ask for changes to this building number 4, and that could be something the Historic Zoning Commission could consider at this time, but they'd like to have the whole thing considered as part of the development plan. Building number 3 is diminutive of building number 4. I do want to seek more information about view sheds from South Margin, if you would see, since this building is not tucked behind number 4, how much you see of that and what that elevation looks like. I do think that most of that could be handled by the Historic Zoning Commission at a later date. Parking should not be proposed in front of principal structures, so in addition to this parking, I would encourage the applicant to remove some of the parking located in front of this building as well. Moving around, building number 1 is of a comparable scale to the historic buildings on the side. It is of a lower scale. It is one story versus the 2 that you see at these buildings. So that is appropriate. I do have some reservations in reviewing this proposal in light of the design guidelines as far as the footprint. And historically, you would have the historic buildings be larger than any buildings that are built onto the site to complement those, or additions to a building to complement the historic building. I would encourage more information to be sought about the screening for the property. We are reviewing this site and setting, but it's also in relation to adjacent structures, as our guidelines would recommend that new construction be comparable to that of existing structures, not only in architectural style, but in placement, in scale, in height, in footprint. We want to make sure that it's a good neighbor to all the buildings around. I do think it's much bigger as a footprint than many of the buildings around, so screening would be entirely appropriate and encouraged, as well as potentially lessening the square footage. As far as the front yard, the Rosenwald schools, as Mr. Stewart noted, historically are orientated north or south. This is a plan B, I believe, and it would have been north or south. So true north, as Mr. Stewart noted, would be the direction that this building is proposed to face, which is toward in the direction of South Margin. If it were to be faced south, you'd see the backside towards South Margin, but would front on an interior drive here. So right now, this does not meet the current zoning ordinance requirements. The applicant is seeking some variance request to have the building not front on a street. If the building were to front south, it would front onto this drive aisle and meet the zoning ordinance. Staff does support relocating the building to the site. It is a historic structure. It's one of significant importance, and I do believe that we could have a good life here. It is atypical to have accessory structure in front of a historic building, but again, this also is a historic building. It serves as a principal structure in its current context, and this is more of a campus type setting. We are not determining use. So I would encourage you to think of this more as a building to complement the site and whether or not the location is appropriate, as well as the orientation. The existing front yard does not have all these walkways, as you all saw at the 3 o'clock meeting. So I've sought some counsel from the State Historic Preservation Office, as well as our design guidelines and reference the zoning ordinance. Lessening the amount of hardscape, which is what the applicant's done between the last meeting and this one, is definitely appropriate. The historic context would have been of a garden type setting without the circular drive. And it maybe perhaps lessening the amount of hardscape further and using softer materials that wouldn't read as stark as perhaps a concrete or an asphalt could be a way to further lessen the impact and appearance of the hardscapes on the property as you look at it from different vantage points on South Margin, Lewisburg, and even on the site itself. The secret garden's an 8-foot wall area that's proposed, I believe, for children. Is that correct, Mr. Stewart? Okay. Typically, walls are reviewed for perimeter locations as property designations to provide privacy from one property line to the next. It is atypical to have walls located in the middle of the site like this, especially at that height. So that is not something that the design guidelines would support. I appreciate, again, your opportunity extended to me to provide additional comments, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have. Thanks.
Okay, commissioners, who wants to be first with quick comments? I won't just call on somebody. Susan.
All right, so I'm going to address my comments primarily to the Rosenwald School, and I've given this a lot of thought. I've looked at what Dr. Hofswally has written, and they face north or south. The thing that I think is really important with this is to really tell the story about the school. And what they did was they would have a large bank of windows, and the windows should face east, because if they faced west, then obviously that would be too much sun coming in during the day. And if you look at, I have actually looked at some schools that are, you know, prior to this, and there were just really tiny windows, so you can see what a difference is made. My thinking is that to use the original portion of the school, that's the part that's most intact. There were no bathrooms in a Rosenwald school. They had a community room, they had cloaked rooms, but they did not have bathrooms. And I think that to really show the public what Rosenwald schools are, we need to show it as it was. And then I think, again, we need to be true to the context of the Rosenwald School. Let it tell the story. My other comment is regarding the mass of the event center. I think that's probably my biggest concern beyond the Rosenwald School, that it's just really too big, you know, and it's going to be competing with the historic buildings. Thank you.
Who's next?
I'm happy to be next.
Lisa, go ahead.
So a question to the applicant. You were here before and you heard our comments, and you said that some things have been adapted to meet what we had said. What are those things besides the hardscape area? What other changes to the original proposal?
One of those was from the original meeting, we moved the schoolhouse and really looked at getting that back into a better place. We have done the hardscape. We've increased some of the distances from the property lines. And we've had extensive conversations with both historic and planning staff about this being a campus that deals with some of the orientation of some of the buildings, not to public streets.
Okay. And you did hear our concerns about the mass of the conservatory, but that hasn't changed.
Not since the last meeting.
Okay. I would agree with my fellow commissioner that to me that seems inconsistent with the neighborhood, with the context of the school, with the history of these treasured buildings that we have on there to begin with, and that a conservatory of that mass would steal the show. So that would be my comment.
Anybody?
Who?
Brian?
I have to agree both with Ms. Rose and Ms. Markwit on those comments. Specifically, as related to the guidelines, even the architectural style of the summer house, I believe it's in a neoclassical form, which is vastly different than the Italianate, and in the rear of the property, as well as the size of the conservatory. Our guidelines say that accessory buildings should be subordinate. And I interpret that not only in height, but in mass and size as well. And then the parking lot that abuts Lewisburg Avenue, our guidelines wouldn't support that, and I couldn't support it as well. One thing I think that's important to bring up, because this site, it's little known that the first Battle of Franklin took place in and around this site in 1863. And it was mainly a cavalry engagement, and there were loss of life. And we're told the bodies that stayed on the hill. So I think some of that needs to be taken consideration too, and maybe telling that story somewhere too. One other thing, I hear Two Rivers Plantation a lot. And I know that's a Nashville property and a pre-war Italianate, but I'd like to see more examples of what's found in Williamson County for Italianate homes in the styling. And I will say that the demolitions that are proposed, I see where they could be appropriate given what is to take place at this site. And one final comment on 8-foot brick walls. The guidelines that I see don't support that either.
Okay, who's next? Mary?
I would support what Brian said, so I won't repeat all that. But just to understand the impact to the historic neighborhood districts around it, I think it would be good to understand, like, where are the service areas for the buildings, and what would kind of lighting would be contemplated. As well, and I guess that would be my main thing.
Mr. Stewart, do you happen to know and could comment now on where those service areas would be, such as loading areas, trash receptacle areas? I know that some of that is more site plan specific, but do you have any idea where those might go?
Sure. For as long as we can determine the trash receptacle has been in the back corner of the lot.
Can you direct me so I can show my cursor?
Sure. It's in the back corner. If you go to the bottom right-hand corner.
Okay. So in here?
Right in the corner is where, the bottom right-hand corner. That's where it's been historically. We're not planning on changing that.
Okay. So,
and there will be a small service area for the venue that is right in the notch in that back wall there, so that a car could pull up there and take in flowers or food or whatever. And for service on the for the Winstead House, it will be in the same location it currently is and has been historically, right on the right-hand side of that building as you're looking at it.
So here?
Yes, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, that's right.
Another comment on projects like this. We have usually had PVC pipe put up so that you could feel and visualize the size of the building. So at some point, that could be good.
Okay.
Are you speaking to the height?
Yeah.
And Mr. Chair, one other question I would have for the applicant, and would I like to have more information on the smokehouse. You know, was it originally on the property? If it was, where was it located? Has it been moved? You know, we talk about the aggregate type foundation that it has, but that could have been put under it and just lifted and put under it in that spot. Sure. So I'd like to have more information on that, on the smokehouse.
You know, we have Rachel Finch here now. Would you like for her to address that?
Fine with me, if somebody can answer the question.
Ms. Finch, if you could speak into one of the microphones, you can hit the button on it to turn on the green light. Thank you. And Ms. Finch is one of she's the senior preservationist at the Heritage Foundation.
Yes, so my name is Rachel Finch. I'm the senior director of preservation and education for the Heritage Foundation. And our team has been conducting the research for Franklin Grove. And to your question for the smokehouse is not sitting in its original location at this time.
Do you know where it was?
It was sitting further back from where it is currently located at this time.
Okay.
I have a question. Have you sought the Sanborn maps? Did they show that site, and did they show the smokehouse on it?
Yes, the Sanborn maps show the smokehouse, we believe, to be from 1913. That is the earliest that we see the smokehouse on a Sanborn map.
So that does
However,
show the location.
It shows a location, but it has two flanking buildings to the side of either side of the smokehouse.
Like additions to the smokehouse?
Additions to the smokehouse, yes. But those do not exist, obviously, at this time. Oh, and would you like me to address the 1863 battle at this time, too?
Sure, sure.
So, yes, we are aware that on April 10th of 1863, the first Battle of Franklin was fought primarily within the area of Franklin Grove. We are also aware of the fact that the significance, historical significance and cultural significance of the Civil War to the site, as well as not just the first Battle of Franklin, but also the November 30th, 1864 battle as well that played a role. And we have had GPR conducted to address any concerns in the back of the property. And at this time, there have been no Civil War artifacts or earthworks discovered through GPR.
And to clarify, GPR is ground penetrating radar. It's a type of technique that is utilized primarily for locating subterranean underground infrastructure. But it has been used in more recent years for the research and interpretation of sites such as this one and others where you are able to determine where there has been disturbances in the ground. And so it has been useful for the benefit of everyone here. We've used that for the city and Rest Haven cemeteries that are publicly owned and maintained on 4th Avenue to be able to tell where bodies are located, where there aren't any markers to indicate such. So Ms. Finch is speaking to, you know, disturbances not being located using that research.
I'm glad to hear that. So that was specifically for bodies, in case there may have been bodies. But even though there are no architectural evidence, we do know that fighting happened around that site.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
And we look forward to interpreting that history as part of the overall interpretation of Franklin Grove.
Glad to hear
and
that.
There's an existing garden wall that we don't think was there during the Civil War. It looks more recent, but it is in the same area where that battle was fought, according to the documents. Mm-hmm. And we are planning on using that as part of telling the story. One of the reasons we want to do this site is because there's so many stories. There's that story. There's such an amazing education story that goes all the way back to the 1830s. And that's the reason that we're doing this. We think that history will play a big part of it.
And I remember when I first came to Franklin in 1988, you know, really straining to see past the trees, the Perkins Winstead House, because it's such a great site. Mm-hmm. And I commend that that you're preserving it. I just like to see a lot of consideration and thought more taking into the site.
Ryan, I don't want to cut you off, but I want to keep this moving. So anybody else? Kathy?
I have a concern, too, about the 8-foot wall that you mentioned around the secret garden. There's an additional, along with that height, there's an additional wall that connects the conservatory and goes along back towards the front of the site, like separating underneath the Liberty Tree that goes all the way to the summer house. Is that one? That one's also 8-foot as well?
Yes, ma'am. That came about in September and October of 20. We met with neighbors, and they wanted to have privacy, and we felt that would provide a private garden so that any activity within the garden's area would be contained visually within that wall.
But that wall is closest to the Liberty Tree, and then there's a drive on the other side of it, and then the property line?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes.
That.
Ken?
Yes, sir. Unfortunately, I was not available to make the site visit this afternoon. But when I look at the site plan, it's kind of a constricted site plan. I mean, piece of property with the historic structures that you've got in place. There's a lot of hard surface. Was there any consideration of parking off-site and shuttling visitors? Because it appears there's a lot of vehicular traffic around the site that has really created a lot of hard surface, that it's kind of a green oasis spot in the middle of downtown.
Sure. That's a proposal that we have given. It's not currently allowed within the zoning ordinance, but we have requested that we be able to do that. We have 54 parking spaces at the old jail that could be used for shuttling people. That we think that's a good way to do that, to minimize the traffic.
Sarah, my comments, first of all, on schoolhouse, I'm appreciative of Susan's research on that, and I go along with what she said. I'm very much in favor and appreciate the move back of the schoolhouse. I think that was a good move, and I think it will look well. A couple of questions that I want to talk about are the overall heights of the Winstead Summer House and Conservatory. We talked about this at the last meeting, and and the information you provided then said that the eave at the Winstead House was 34 feet, and the summer house eave, you talked about it 21 feet, but then we talked about the peak of the summer house, and that was another 4 feet, so that's 25 feet above grade. And then the conservatory, which was 20 foot 6 above grade to the eave, you said the overall height to the top of the cupola was 33 feet. So it's a foot off of what the Winstead eave is. And I know the property from the distance back drops off, but that's, are those the correct numbers still?
Those are the correct numbers. You know, certainly the height doesn't have to be that tall.
It's a one-story structure. We did have a cupola on top. You know, that's something I'd appreciate y'all's comments about as well.
Well, I mean, I don't have any. I'm just looking at what I see right here. So if you want to change, that's up to you. But that's a significant structure as it impacts, and that'll lead me into the next one. The side and rear property owners. I think that height would adversely impact them. Also, and I guess the stakes today showed the story. That is a tremendous mass on the back of that property. Can you describe again, you said out there at the site visit, how the property distance, but would you go on from the rear of the conservatory to the rear property line and on either side, what those distances are?
Sure, it's 46 feet, 8 inches from the rear of the conservatory to the property line. And it is 53 feet, 7 inches to the east property line.
East being 4th
Avenue?
4th Avenue. Right. Oh, well, did you say that again? 50 what?
53 feet, 7 inches.
And, okay, then toward Berry Circle is what?
36 feet, 8 inches.
And, Mr. Chair, what is the buffering width from the conservatory to the property line? I know there's the conservatory, and then there's the roadway, and then...
You're talking about the brick wall buffer? Well,
the, no, on the exterior, very exterior of the property line, how is the wood fence the buffering, or will it have landscaping, and if so, how much?
So what we have is a, there's actually a fence that the condos have on their property, and then there's the wood fence that's a couple of 3 feet away from that, and then there'll be 5 feet of landscaping and then a parking area before you get to the conservatory.
And then the 5 feet goes all the way down the other houses,
Well, and it's actually 8 foot, 7 inches on the 4th Avenue side there at the conservatory.
So with that in mind, I do think it would be extremely helpful for when this item comes forward for a formal recommendation from the Historic Zoning Commission if the property line distances to the improvements are marked clearly for everyone to be able to understand. What I mean by that is the property line called out, you know, any sort of screening mechanism, whether it's a wall or a fence, be called out, and then the distance between that wall or fence to the parking area and then to the building itself, so that it's clear what those spaces are, what those spaces are proposed to be used for.
And also, I'd like to add too back about the wall connecting the conservatory. I would need to see how that is delineated, and then the massing of that wall width-wise versus height-wise, are there penetrating open parts to it? And then it basically masses the conservatory, that whole back end of the property, and then it's just adding to the mass of it in what it appears on the plan. If we could delineate that more, that would be helpful.
Okay, is there anything else so we can, we're out of time about on this one. So unless somebody's got something else, Amanda, do you want to say any other, make any other comments?
I don't, other than just to reiterate that the applicant intends to bring forward the proposal for a formal recommendation from the Historic Zoning Commission at its January meeting. So again, if anyone has any questions, commissioners, applicant, citizens alike, feel free to contact me. My name is Amanda Rose. You can contact me at 791-3212. Which is the planning office number, 791-3212. Or you can email me, and I can certainly provide additional information on that. I've shared it with many of you. Feel free to share with all your friends and neighbors. We're happy to help answer any questions about process and proposal. Thank you.
Cheryl, thank you. Anything else?
I do want to thank Amanda for the guidance she's given. A lot of the information we've put together has been in response to what y'all have done and her suggestions as well. We also plan to, we'll describe what you're all talking about with the walls and things, as well as extend that site section to include the condos and what they can see from their windows.
So. Okay, very good. Thank you. Rachel, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to wait just a minute, let the folks clear.
Is it hot in here?
Most of them are leaving, so. Okay, I think we're ready now for our second item, discussion of preliminary recommendation for Emeline Acres subdivision proposed at southeast and southwest corners of the intersection of Mack Hatcher and Franklin Road, Kiser Vogrin Design applicant. Amanda, do you have any comments on this one?
I'd like for the applicant to speak first, if that's okay
with you. That's fine. And if y'all would just introduce yourself and...
And I do want to remind everyone that this item has been heard by the DRC and the Historic Zoning Commission before. So we would encourage the applicant in the interest of time to really go over the proposed changes to the previous plan as opposed to explaining the plan in its entirety.
Right, and we want to try to do this in about 15 minutes if we can. So if you can just hit the changes, is the big thing.
Okay, I'm bringing up the screen right now if you'll bear with me.
Perfect. Thanks, Amanda. I'm Katie Radowski. I'm with Kiser Vogrin Design, the applicant on the project. This is Christian Dial.
I'm with Capital Investment Group for the developer on the project.
So, understanding time, if you can actually go to, I believe it's page 7, Amanda, of...
I'm on page 7.
Oh. Go to the site plan, which I believe is a few more down. Yep. There you go. Okay, so we have made several large changes to the site plan since we last met with you all. A few items in particular we're going to talk about today. The first being that we have reduced the amount of not only single family but multiplex units facing Franklin Road. And that's what I would like to really hone in on during our discussion. So currently on the plan that you see, there are 6 multiplex units on the east side of Franklin Road and 6 multiplex units on the west side of Franklin Road. We have removed all single family from this street. Another piece that we've been working with Amanda through is comparing this entrance to Franklin Road and to downtown Franklin to Harlansdale Manor. And in analyzing Harlansdale Manor, they are currently using setbacks that are about 55 feet apart between houses. One thing that I would like to bring about is that we now, with the changes that we've made specifically to Franklin Road, we have about 75 feet average of separation on the west side of Franklin Road and about 69 feet of separation on the east side of Franklin Road. So those setbacks range anywhere from 51 feet to 115 feet on the west side and 47 feet to 107 feet on the east side. The other comparison I would like to make are the lot widths. So Harlansdale Manor has approximately, or uses approximately 125 to 175 foot lot widths. Our lot widths on this revised plan now show 125 feet to 235 feet on the west side of Franklin Road and 90 feet to 120 feet on the east side of Franklin Road. With that, I think I will open it up to questions. We do want to take this time to really hear from you all. And I'll end there.
Thank you, Katie. And I want to take the opportunity to thank Katie, Gary Vogrin, also from Kiser Vogrin Design, and Christian Dial, the owner representative, for working so closely with staff over the last few renditions to try to get to a point that we all could feel comfortable as far as the context of this northern portion of Franklin Road between Mack Hatcher and downtown. So I'll kind of reiterate some of the things that Katie noted. Some of the things that staff really wanted to encourage to have better consistency with the Envision Franklin land use plan document, with the historic district design guidelines, would be that there would be more significant spacing between buildings. The Historic Zoning Commission has identified Harlansdale Manor just south of here as a infill residential development that has appropriate context because it's kind of set the tone. We reiterated some of those standards, such as building spacing between buildings, building form to the applicant to consider. Excuse me. So as Ms. Radowski was mentioning, there is 55 feet between the buildings at Harlansdale Manor that front Franklin Road. I can't say the same for the buildings interior, but you don't see this distance between those buildings as much from the street as you do the ones at front Franklin Road. So using that as a guideline by which to plan, you know, this proposal, the applicant has largely met that. It is a little tighter between these two forms, but I do believe, because this is a conservation easement, it is 75 feet in width, it is not part of the lot itself. From Franklin Road, you're going to experience all these trees to help buffer the development away from the Creekside Historic Mansion, that you will feel like there is significant enough spacing between these buildings. I want to note that the applicant has removed the residential single-family form and is proposing a residential multiplex form fronting Franklin Road on either side, because that type of building form would be of a greater mass. And massing is significant as a consideration on Franklin Road because the types of buildings that you see are more rural in context, and the styles that we see have a little bit more substance with massing, such as the Creekside Manor that you see here. So having a wider building width rather than a very narrow, like more skinny building width is supported because the context would call for that. So having six buildings here as opposed to a handful more residential single family here would be more appropriate. The next thing I want to point out is the screening. The applicant has taken into account some of staff's comments about screening Franklin Road specifically from the development proposed behind. Admittedly, the average person would see these liner buildings, what we're calling liner buildings, more so than they would see anything behind it. So we have spent a lot more time reviewing these buildings for contextual appropriateness. But all that said, when you increase spacing between buildings, you might see some of this behind. So we have encouraged a lot of landscaping to be proposed to screen some of the development behind the liner buildings. We would encourage that it would be a little less regular than what you see here, because historically, as farms developed, as you know, large sites developed, you would see farm line batteries that were kind of evolved where fence lines were, or not where fence lines were, where you just have natural occurring tree line, animals dropping seeds, things like that. So we want this to be a little more organic feeling, but we also want a mechanism by which to ensure that this landscaping is in place in perpetuity. So permanent maintenance of this landscaping, so it could help screen the development proposed behind from the Franklin Road feed sheds. And also the folks who would be living in these multiplexes would have a little bit more significant screening away from the rest of the development. I do want to remind you that this would be a preliminary recommendation request too from the Historic Zoning Commission to the Planning Commission and the BOMA. So architecture would be something that would be worked out later by the Historic Zoning Commission at concurrent to the site plan stage if approved for a development plan. So we would review that for a COA for each individual resident, the liner buildings and all the other buildings behind that happen to fall in the historic preservation overlay. So it'll be a huge undertaking on Historic Zoning Commission, but we will ensure that it meets all the buildings meet the guidelines recommendations at that point in time. My last comment is that these forms appear to be pretty regularly massed and spaced throughout here. We'd like to see a little bit more organic form so that it feels more planned over time as opposed to planned all at one time. You see a lot of different massing types up and down Franklin Road. So I can't really tell so much from this. It is a development plan stage after all. But we would want the applicant to think ahead for when we review for a certificate of appropriateness for each of these buildings, and know that the expectation will that be that they do not have the same width all the way across on both sides of the street. Thank you.
Okay, commissioners, questions?
Oh.
Mary, go ahead.
I was just wondering if we could pull up
an aerial view so that we could see the adjacent properties, just for a contextual perspective?
Ms. Marquardt, you want an aerial view or do you want a street view?
Actually, I was kind of a satellite view, I guess.
Okay.
Could, yeah,
I can definitely
the
do
right
that.
Way to call it.
Give me just a moment.
Mary, would you like to go ahead with your comment in the meantime?
If I think I'm correct, this requires a rezoning. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
And it is now, what, one unit to the 2 acres? The current zoning, and you will be going to what?
It's
density?
Proposed to be a PD, which is a planned development with a density to be provided by the applicant. I don't know that number off the top of my head. Katie, can you provide that, please?
Yes, give us 1 second to do the quick math.
Okay.
Anyway, one unit per 2 acres.
I was just going to say, there was two of the people that were aldermen at the time are in the room, just coincidentally, Mr. Bacon and Ms. Pam Lewis. And I feel like that there was big support for the one unit to the 2 acre at the time. And this is one of our most untouched gateways into downtown. And to me, this is so far off the reservation of what we can do to carry Franklin forward as not anywhere USA. I feel like we, on the other corner of Mack Hatcher, have got a development that just looks like suburbia. And so it was kind of, I thought, well, once you cross Mack Hatcher, you will come into historic Franklin. So I have trouble deciding if they should set back different or do what, because I just feel like it's so far from anything that I think would be for carrying forth historic Franklin. So that's just my comment.
Okay. Did go back to Lisa's.
And if you could put your cursor on Harlansdale.
Sure. This is Harlansdale Manor subdivision. This is the location of the historic Creekside property. And then these two parcels here are the parcels that are proposed to be developed.
Okay.
So that 55-foot width was drawn from an evaluation of how far apart these buildings are from each other.
Well, Mr. Chair, Harlansdale, I think, is good inspiration. It's tucked in. It's single family. It's not a lot of density. It doesn't have multiplexes. So when I made that comment about Harlansdale, that's what I was talking about.
Do you have anything else, Lisa?
How many homes are in Harlansdale Manor at the moment? Just more or less.
There are 10 or 12.
10 or 12, okay.
I think that's fair to say.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Probably closer to 12.
Yeah, I would concur with with what Mary has stated.
Okay, Ken?
Yes, so I heard single family and I heard multiplexes. Can you describe the proposed housing types?
The single family housing, there's 32 lots of that type, and they are set up so they're in the rear of the property, but on a little bit more infill context, and vary from as small as 40-foot wide lots up to, I believe, 65 feet. The multiplex are four-unit buildings that we've come up with a design that they resemble a large estate home, much like the large homes in downtown Franklin that have been subdivided into multiple units, but they still resemble historic structure and home. And there's only one entrance shown on the front of the property. So from the naked eye, it looks like you're looking at a single family home. And all the garages are in the rear yards. And we have a lot of flexibility with the site plan too, to come up with an organic context of how those buildings are placed on the site. Some may be L-shaped and come back into the rear yard more. Some may be wider lots or wider frontages with large stately front porches on them. And so we're gonna dive into the, once we get into architectural review, into making those feel very organic and look like historic structures.
So there's two building types.
There's two building types.
And I can help frame that the intent of the design guidelines is to have a building that appears to be a single family residence for the multiplexes. We don't regulate use, and so by use it'd be, you know, multiple building occupants versus single family. But the intent is to have a, you know, a maximum two-story scale single family residence appearance from Franklin Road, regardless of how many units are in the building.
Okay, who's next? Brian?
I have a question, because we have a national registered property that's part of the site.
Mm-hmm.
And if I read through some of the literature, could you go through what's going to happen to Creekside and what's being proposed?
Yeah. So Creekside has been in need of a little bit of TLC for a while now. It's currently being rented out to as a single family residence to someone. We intend to make that a community center of our development. We've looked at also creating a single family home back out of it, but right now we're proposing it to be our main office and also kind of function as a library space, space that, you know, we might have a little coffee set up in there for people on the property to come, you know, get their cup of coffee. So we'd like to reprogram it into an amenity, and we can, you know, by doing the development, it allows us to have the funds to spend a considerable amount of money to get that to its original state and preserve it for the long term.
You mentioned that the consideration had been taken to keep it as a single family residence. And recently we had a proposal from a developer of a home in Franklin, and they're planning to do just that with that development. And I'll say something about Creekside, although it is in need of some TLC. There's no doubt about it.
Mm-hmm.
But that also is good, because it means it hasn't been muddled up over the years. So you have a gem to work with. And I would encourage thinking, giving more consideration to, because where the developer's concerned, it's a good financial for what homes are worth now in Williams County and Franklin. I think it will actually help their bottom line in selling that property as a single family residence. And one of the reasons I say that, because the Christopher McEwen home, which is where the Tennessee Golf Club is, it lost its national register status because of the upgrades that were done to it as a community center.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just throwing that out.
Okay, Susan?
I will be honest with you, I just can't support this density, you know, and that corridor. It's, I know that you've reduced the amount that's in there, but I can't in good conscience support the density. Thank you.
Anybody else? I concur with Ms. Besser. I'm not going to support this. He's reduced it from 166 to 161. Now it's 152. Is that it? And I still cannot support this level of density in this corridor, which is still a pretty pristine entry into Franklin.
And Mr. Chair, I hope that my comments were led one to believe I couldn't support this density.
I gathered.
And it is a rezoning.
Yes,
so.
It is. And all of this has got to move its way forward. It's just like the first applicant that we heard
but,
from.
But when you have by right zoning, we wouldn't be able to say we wanted less density. We are in a fortunate position in this one to say that doesn't fit in with the neighborhood scale.
Mm-hmm. Okay, character. Anything else from anyone? All right, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we're ready for number three, discussion of alterations. Window replacement at 113 2nd Avenue South. Centric architecture. Actually, that's St. Philip's Catholic Church. And I'm assuming this is Luke and Gina.
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Amanda, did you have any opening comments for this or just defer to the applicant?
Ms. Hensley will be presenting comments, but we'd like the applicant to present first, please.
All right.
Okay.
You're on.
Thank you. My name is Gina Emanuel. I'm a Centric Architecture. And as you noted, this is St. Philip Catholic Church, which is very close to here. We have been doing a couple of small renovations on the interior. A project we did earlier last year was to upgrade the sprinkler system. The building was not sprinklered, so we added that, which was a great add for them. And we came back to this one area that you see highlighted in red at the bottom, and that spot is also undergoing, it's their classroom section of the building, it's undergoing a renovation on the interior as well. What has happened is if you go to the next couple of slides, Amanda, we're going to show you what looks up on the, if we can, there's some photos in there, I think, showing the outside. You can see most of these are facing Main Street. And the main church, where the church is now, the windows were replaced at some point. I'm not exactly sure when that was done. This building that we're looking at right now, they were not replaced. And so really, as a part of this renovation, we want to replace them to match the rest of the church. So they are, I believe they will be aluminum on the exterior and the interior is wood. And so that's currently what is on most of the campus with the exception of this building. So really that's what we are asking for your approval on, is to be able to replace those windows as a part of our project. And there's a couple of views showing here where you will see it from. Predominantly all of this is from East Main that you'll see. And that's a close-up view, that one that was just, that the big image there as you go down, that's showing what's on the main church building now that were replaced previously.
And you're going to replace them with what?
Those are the ones that are there that we were going to replace to look like those.
Okay.
The current ones that we're talking about do not match those.
So how many windows are we talking about? I didn't count them.
We've got four for sure that they want to replace. They are also talked about doing another four in a building adjacent. So it would be eight total if they did it all.
Got it. Okay, Victoria?
Okay, so can we actually pull up the street view, Amanda, please?
Victoria, you need to come closer to the mic.
We actually also have a question for the applicant. Is the proposal to change the window opening size or to replace within the current size already there?
Replace within the current size.
Okay,
so no change to the openings.
Okay. The windows are obviously not historic because they are on an addition to the historic building. But whatever goes back into these needs to meet the guidelines. But the opening widths of the windows proposed to be replaced do not match the opening widths the applicant is seeking to match. And so staff believes that they are narrow and shorter, so changing them will not actually be a true match to the portion of the building that they are wanting to match now. And also there are numerous styles and different parts of the building, which shows evolution over time and how the building has changed over time. Therefore, staff would not necessarily recommend matching these windows to the portion of the building that the applicant is seeking to match.
Ready? You ready for
it? Do you guys have any questions on what Victoria stated?
Maybe I'm the only one, but I'm not fully understanding exactly what we're doing here.
Okay.
Well, other than replacing windows.
I can help explain that. So right now the building has, on the side that is closest to First Avenue, you have the former bank.
Right.
It has, you know, fixed windows, six lights. The middle section here has the windows that are a little shorter and a little narrower, that are just two lights, you know, more a little bit more modern take. And then you have the historic chapel located here that has more of a Gothic style window. Then over here you have more Gothic style windows on an addition here. So the building has had a lot of changes over time. You have a lot of different window types. So Ms. Hensley's point is that if you're not changing the proposed opening, like how big the window is, and you're just simply taking the sash out and putting in a new window, then these aren't really going to match, because these windows are much larger windows than these openings here. So it may not achieve what the applicant's intent is if they simply just have six grid window replacements here and then here. It may be better just to leave that to show evolution over time. It could be supported, however, if the applicant wanted to make the openings wider and so that those windows could be truly matching the ones elsewhere on the building.
So, Gina, do you have the sizes of those windows?
Do you know? Those look. I don't think we know the exact size. We'll have to follow up.
What is the primary objective here? Is there issues with the existing windows?
Yeah, they're old windows. They're in disrepair. And so as a part of this interior work that we're doing, those are classrooms, like I mentioned, they wanted to go ahead and get those windows fixed and replaced. So I think we hadn't thought about widening them just from the work that would have to happen in that building that I don't think that they would necessarily want to, you know, undertake. So that's why we were just hoping to replace them.
I think it would be helpful if we could see a profile that's proposed for those and compared to the existing.
Yeah.
Or, Mr. Chair, if they were just replaced in kind.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
To match what is currently shown there? So you all would be more supportive of something like that, just more of that style?
Idea of increasing the size of the openings to try to match it with a part of the building that was probably existing. I don't know the history of these two portions of the church, but
I don't think they're even asking to do that. I think what they're asking.
Right. No, but that's what I heard from. What I'm saying is that. I got the impression that what you were asking is to match the style in terms of the openings of the windows, keep the size as is, correct? Mm-hmm. And then our guidelines do identify that the materials should be like a composite, not aluminum, I think you mentioned. So those are my comments.
So it is your intent that you replace in kind, or at least you're replacing you're changing out the windows that are there and can put down the same size. That's
right.
That's the bottom line.
That's right. And if you want to,
that's what you want to do.
Yes. And the very last page, Luke just reminded me, we kind of show what they would look like. So if you want, Amanda, if you want to go to our very last page, this may answer. This was the intent. It's drawing A402. It may be a couple up. Sorry, Amanda.
That's part of the reason staff had questions, is that these drawings seem to indicate that the window openings are larger than what currently exist. So we just wanted to make sure, because you can see existing above and then existing below.
So
those are the same. They just seem wider than, especially the ones on northeast elevation, just seem bigger than what's currently existing.
Well,
they're the same size, just with divided plates.
Okay.
Okay, anybody else got any other comments?
So I want to make sure I understand the direction that's being given by the DRC. The things I have heard would be that it would be appropriate for the applicant to provide a profile of the proposed versus existing, so it's better understood side by side to be able to tell. A comment about materials, I do want to note that the guidelines do state that on commercial buildings, which this isn't exactly a commercial building, but the windows relate to that on the historic building. The historic building has stained glass, and so it may be that it relates to the rest of the building. Aluminum is something that is currently approvable for new construction. I don't know that I would encourage aluminum for a historic building. Because this is a non-contributing element of a historic building, I think that the applicant should bring forward something that is similar to what you see elsewhere on the building that's comparable to that window type. Obviously, the stained glass is not comparable to that window type. But then also, too, I heard the comment about replacement in kind, so that you are getting the window replacement need addressed, but it's not changing the appearance of the window in any substantial way.
I was just going to say, if you come to the Historic Zoning Commission meeting and have options, then I think it could be resolved. Look at what's available that mirrors what's existing and then what you would propose.
And Mr. Chair, I think if they can look at a composite material, this has, it's an infill project that just has had a lot of change. And like, I think a lot of us been built for function over time. And if this is an opportunity to upgrade, that would be amazing.
Well, I don't necessarily agree with that because this is a commercial building.
Okay, it is.
It's not a residence.
It's commercial. Mm-hmm. Okay.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
Any other comments? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll be in touch with you with some next steps.
All right. We're ready for number four. Discussion of signage at 252 Fifth Avenue North. Sam Johnson, applicant. Good evening, Amanda. Do you have anything, or just go ahead, Mr. Johnson?
Our business is located on Fourth Avenue North. Not a day goes by where somebody doesn't say, "I've heard about you, but we have no idea that you were back here." It's just a untrafficated part of town. It's a lovely place amongst the cemeteries, and we purchased 252 Fifth Avenue North. Nate Alexander in late August, and so we intend to save that building for at least the next 10 years. We're applying for use for a high-end outdoor furniture retail use of that, and we intend to go out as much time as happens before redevelopment occurs in this flood zone to allow people to see this very quaint interior. It's got beautiful trusses on the inside and skylights. It was an old dry cleaners from 1942. So we hope to save that for the next 10 years or so before the plan subsides again. But right now we'd like to take advantage of that Hillsborough Road facing side and restrict the financial motivations to direct some folks back to our very quaint 324th Avenue North storehouse number 9, which has become a destination for home goods shoppers, retail use.
And I guess my microphone should have been turned on.
We heard you did, but they didn't pick up on the recording. So
okay, you mean me to repeat all that?
No.
But 2.5 years ago, we opened storehouse number 9, and it's been a very well-received retail establishment there. My wife runs it, and our daughter, family organization, and we just like to direct some more traffic, just some visual impressions on the Hillsborough roadside.
All right, thank you. Okay, staff.
Thank you. We did ask Mr. Johnson to consider coming to speak to you today to receive some feedback because this is a unique situation. I commend him for coming forward, and I commend him for wanting to save this awesome building that we see on the screen. It is, I don't know if you've all been inside, but it is very charming.
It's
it has
lovely.
A lot of potential.
Oh, yes, I've been inside.
Yeah.
Many years ago.
Every week?
Yep, once a week.
The signs could qualify for administrative review, but we take our administrative review responsibilities very seriously. The guidelines recommend that signs be placed in typical locations that you see on other buildings, and that the building context itself will most of the time dictate where a sign should go. We review signage for placement, for materials, for sizing, and for colors, but we do not review messages. That is not something that the city of Franklin reviews at all for signage anywhere in the city. So I am looking at it specifically for the location, size, color, and the material. So as proposed, the location is a little bit out of the ordinary from what you see on neighboring properties. I do have a building that's next door that put a sign up without approval, so that is being addressed currently. But all that to say that, you know, typically a sign for a building would be on the front near the entrance, or it would be a little bit lower and not as high up toward the roof line. We could go on the street view and I can show you some of those things. This is a ever-evolving section of the district, as you all know. So the signs, there's a lot of monument signs, freestanding signs here too. This building has a monument sign located in front of it with no panels, so that could be an opportunity for this building as well. As far as color, the colors are reversed from what would be recommended or guidelines recommend, a darker background with lighter lettering. I don't remember, and I hope Mr. Johnson can comment, was your intent to paint directly onto the side?
Yeah, right on the CMU, just paint on the CMU.
Oh, okay, so that color wouldn't necessarily apply because it's not something like with a backer applied to the building. But the location and it's generally the location is the more problematic part in why the staff had encouraged a comment here, because it's not entirely consistent with the recommendations of the guidelines.
I'll comment on the monuments. We intend to use those for the actual outdoor furnishings, retail outfit in the front of that building. So they have a purpose eventually, upon approval, of course. This is more of a mural type of a directional sign that simply, and we tried to keep it as simple as possible, that said one block turn left and that's it, as well as our logo. Mm-hmm.
Comments?
Mr. Chair, I'm confused. The monument sign would be, help me with that. Say that one more time.
Let me pull up the street view. I think that'll help a little bit.
I think the monument sign would direct business to the building. We don't want this sign to do that. We want it to direct business to our other building just on the same block.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a different use of the side of the building than the monument sign.
Okay.
And the Historic Zoning Commission does not review content. We review placement. And so messaging aside, am I going
back the other way?
And going the wrong direction. Yeah. Messaging aside, it's more about where the number of, that's one thing I failed to mention, not the count of signs and the location contextually sensitive to the site itself.
Where those cars are parked there would be ideally our outdoor furnishings, high-end swimming pool, courtyard type of furnishings. Mm-hmm. And then that monument there in front of that white truck would be for that purpose of the outdoor line.
So let's just clarify. The business that you want to advertise on this sign is the business that's one street over. You've got a separate business that will be in this building.
It's
on
the same block. It's just behind the cemetery.
I understand. I know where it is.
You can't see it. It's behind the
I'm just trying to make sure everybody on this committee knows that the sign he's wanting to put up is for a business that's not on this site.
That's
right, but the message does not matter.
No, it does. Okay, I just want everybody to understand right. That.
And one thing I want to note is this is the street view. Mr. Johnson, do you own this property as well?
Or just I did this purchase property? The lot as well, yes.
You did purchase both, okay.
I purchased both lots.
Okay, so there are currently two freestanding signs. The guidelines would recommend that you use one freestanding sign per street frontage. So we may have to talk internally and provide some guidance to Mr. Johnson on having two of these here. But ultimately, staff would recommend that signage for this building, regardless of use, we're not talking about use, we're not talking about what business is what, but signage for this lot, for this building, would be on the front here where you see ghosting, where a sign used to be, in this freestanding existing monument sign, and otherwise in locations that are comparable to other buildings, which are not as close to the roof.
And I'm happy to remove that second monument in front of the parking lot at my expense.
Can
staff address for me zoning and codes for off-site signage?
Off-site signage doesn't exist because we do not review content. That is federal law.
Say that again. Say that again. Off-site signage is what, Amanda?
We don't consider the message of the sign. So you really have to look at this sign based on its location, its size, its placement, not necessarily what it says. The guidelines say no more than three signs. So that's what you're really looking at, not which business the sign is advertising or pointing direction to.
Well, I don't know that I buy that.
It's case law that we're following.
There's a good example.
Wait a minute. But we've got, this is a billboard, is what it is.
Yes, that's correct.
It's a billboard.
I agree.
It's not an on-premise sign, which is what his storefront business would have and is what this new business will have in front of it.
I understand, Mr. Roberts. I totally understand what you're saying, but off-premise signage is not a concept that exists because case law has dictated that the message of a sign cannot be used to determine whether or not a sign is appropriate.
So what is the staff's position on the size and location of the proposed signage? Just if you can say that for me one more time. Under the guidelines and in comparison with what we've done with other buildings?
There is no billboard type placement on any signs or on any buildings in this general vicinity. So it is just in a location that's irregular to what you see on other buildings in this vicinity. There is a sign, as I noted, on the next building over that was applied to a building without approval. It is located a little lower. It's more midway on the building, which is appropriate presumably for that building, but it is not one I want the commission to consider as a sign that has been approved because it's not one that has. So I can go on the street view if you desire, and you can kind of see there's a lot of monument signs that were done as part of streetscape. We've had signage that I think this was vacant until recently. There is a sign that was added here.
It's still vacant.
Okay, I'm thinking of the building here when I said next door. There's a lot of window decal signage. These buildings don't super lend themselves to a lot of wall signage, and so there has been a lot of requests for having wall signs on the sides of buildings, but when possible, the guidelines would encourage that they be emplacement that would be lending themselves to what you'd see historically, like cornice fascia boards or false fronts like you see on this building that Mr. Johnson owns.
So let's cut to the chase here. Is staff saying you would support such a sign?
I would support the sign based on the guidelines if it were lower in coordination with placement on other buildings. The rationale that Mr. Johnson has, I believe, is because there's a window here. So I would like the commission to give feedback on the appropriateness of placement, in relation to the other signs that he may propose in the future for use on this particular building. There's a limitation in the guidelines for three signs per building.
So you do plan to add a sign to the front eventually?
Yes, but for a different purpose.
It's
going to be labeled Summer Classics,
right?
Outdoor furnishings rather than Storehouse Number 9.
Mm-hmm.
These are both furnishing companies, and so you have different lines of merchandise in the two of them, is what I understand?
We hope. That's pending approval by the city, of course, but they did approve a retail use there, which is a positive step.
Yeah. I have not seen it in Franklin, but certainly there's a historic precedence with painted signs on masonry buildings. You see them in other areas, but I have not seen such a sign in Franklin anywhere. They probably existed at one time.
I agree. There were definitely signs that existed at one point. We've lost most all of those.
And I concur with that, and I feel like the character of this building lends itself to that. I might prefer that it be a bit lower. And I think what the applicant's saying, that white that we're seeing like a big white square was just a computer.
Yes, a computer white. It'll all be the same white. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So I could support it at a somewhat lower.
The removal of that metal awning could accommodate a lower placement for sure. I don't know how important mm-hmm. that is historically. I think it was the drive-through to pick up your dry cleaning.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd happy to leave it. But I think it, well,
but this,
no.
I'm excited that something's coming.
Kathy. I love the building. It's a spectacular building.
Kathy, you got a comment?
Yeah, does staff have a recommendation for how much space the sign would occupy in relation to the height and placement?
Sure. The guidelines recommend that wall signs be limited to no more than 1 square foot per linear foot of width of the facade. Now, of course, that would present a huge wall sign, but the guidelines also have, there's also additional guidelines that talk about coordinating the size and placement with surrounding buildings. And so
it still acts within the parameters of a sign, not a mural. Not
correct.
Like the Welcome to City Franklin mural that's a little further down the road.
Yes, that was approved by the Public Art Commission as a, not a sign, but a public art installation.
But this is not a... No. This is a sign.
Right. Okay. It is, the intent is to identify a business. Okay. If the applicant wanted to ask for it to be approved as art, he certainly could. I don't believe that would be supported, but we asked the applicant to make a request based on if it's intended to signal a business or not.
Should we have some type of rendering or some type of a drawing at the next submittal to look at?
Yes. What I would suggest that Mr. Johnson do for the formal application is, I agree that removing this awning and having it lower would be better in keeping with the location of signs on adjacent buildings. I'd like to have dimensions of the sign and maybe have it, you know, a little bit more contextually sensitive to this window in this building. So it may be that you adjust it to be wider or shorter in order to fit that space like it was intended to be there. Mm-hmm. And then that way we would have a better sense of where it's going on the building and exactly how that would look. And maybe take photos of adjacent building sign locations to show the placement in relation. But I definitely agree lowering it would be more in keeping with the intent. The reason this was brought forward is because staff felt it wasn't entirely inconsistent with the guidelines, but it's just not entirely in keeping. We take that responsibility very seriously.
Any other comments? Other than the fact, I can't support a sign on a building that advertises another business that's not located on that property.
It's the same business. It's an extension of the business.
I won't get into a debate on that, but that's not what I'm saying, because you're directing traffic to another location. So anyway, but that's my opinion. So I think we're done. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. We'll be in touch with next steps.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, discussion of alterations, window placement at 226 Fifth Avenue South. Denise Kane, applicant. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kane. It's nice to meet you.
Hi. Can you hear me? Hi.
Hi.
So I am Denise Kane, and my husband and I purchased 226 Fifth Avenue South just over a year ago. We are very excited to be the owners of this historic residence. We bought it because it's a historic residence, and we love that about it. It's a magical place with lots of charm. It does have, oh, there it is. It has some issues with the windows. So it's on the corner of Fifth Avenue South and South Margin. You guys are familiar with it because of what's happening across the street. So the windows are not alike across the front of the house and the side. I'm guessing that right now we're looking at the front of the house. Those are probably the oldest windows. And those are different from the ones on the far left side on South Margin. That's the porch.
I don't have a great photograph here, but I do have a street view I can pull up.
The one at Christmas time? Did I submit that one?
No, I only have the two photos that are shown.
Okay. Anyways, the far left side of the house on South Margin, across the street, at one point was a garage. we think we have a historical photo that shows that it looks like a garage right there on the left. It has been converted into a bedroom. So those are much newer windows. One of the panes is broken. It's not tempered glass. And then on the side of that room, there's another window that has, yeah, right there. It's different than all the other windows. It has divided light. And then one of the windows in the front of the house has divided light just on the top. And then the windows
Can you point out that one for me, please?
Yeah, so go back to the other side by the porch. If you go around the porch, keep going, and then turn right there to the left of the chimney stack, that one has divided light just on the top.
Okay, I see.
Right there, yeah. So anyways, the point is that we would like to fix the broken windows and make all the windows uniform. The windows in the front to the left of this same room, that's our living room by the porch, they have something called an OG sash lug. So I'm assuming that those are the oldest windows of the house because they're the most deteriorated. They're wood. I do have photos of the wood deterioration. Some of the windows don't open. Some of the sashes are broken, so they slam down. So the goal is to replace all of them with wood historic windows, wood windows that match the historic windows, not change the size or dimensions at all, and keep the existing trim on the outside. So it would be removed, replace the windows, and put them back.
Okay, staff.
So the guidelines recommend against the replacement of historic windows. And as our applicant just walked us through the survey of the windows across the house, staff would support the replacement of the vinyl windows and the window that has the divided light. But again, the guidelines do recommend maintaining the historic windows.
Okay. Committee? The window man. Yes.
Yeah. Oh, you're the window man.
Anyway.
Okay. Thank you.
Old house purchase. I mean, what greater to own an old house than the city of Franklin? It certainly is.
We know.
And you mentioned several words, and those charm and character. Mm-hmm. And to me, windows do so much to contribute to the charm and character, especially historic windows, to a house. And they're irreplaceable with modern windows. And another thing that I often think too, the Victorians saw windows as the eyes of the house, almost the windows of the soul. So what we, since the guidelines recommend against replacing your historic windows, mm-hmm. they can certainly be repaired. And be repaired, I would say, for much less expense than replacing all those windows. And I'll say get something else on the OG sash lug.
Yeah.
So I know many historic homes in Franklin have different styles, some with the lugs, some with not.
The same house?
They're on the same house.
Yeah. Okay.
The same with the window patterns. Often you would put your cheaper windows in the back, and they would have the divided glass, especially on one of your vintage, and your 1:1 windows in the front. We use that term, putting on the front, so you're putting your best front forward with those windows. So it's not uncommon to see different style houses, windows on a historic house. That's part of the charm and the character of it.
Brian, do you mind explaining for everyone in the room why 1:1 would be the eyes to the front of the building versus being in the back?
Well, just before they're putting their best front forward.
Right, and it's because of the glass cost, correct?
It would be because of the glass. Mm-hmm. She's exactly right.
Yeah.
So the larger panes of glass, they were actually hand-blown. And they're blown into a cylinder, and then they're heated up and scored and flattened out, and that's why they have all that waviness and bubble. Your windows will also have glazing on the outside, and probably some of that may be peeling off. That's kind of what you're seeing, probably.
Yeah.
But that can be repaired as well. They can be reglazed. And back to the energy cost.
Right.
So studies have shown that the money that's spent on new windows, that you will never recoup that cost in energy savings in the life of that home. So storm windows are a good thing to use. And you can either use, I know you've got them now,
mm-hmm.
You can either use those. Some have screens, so you can still raise the window, and they can be made operable again for the weights and pulleys. But you can also get a plate glass window, too, that actually shows what both sashes look like. So there's a lot of options in
on
repair.
On the exterior?
On the exterior?
We did it at the Franklin Theater on the interior, and it ended up being pretty spectacular.
And you
we
can
did
do them.
A solid plump pane of glass with wood.
Yes.
On the interior, and you could open the window and, you know, or close it all.
So we consulted with an architect, mm-hmm. and he introduced that idea to me because I didn't know that that mm-hmm. existed. Currently, there are storm windows on the exterior, and in my personal opinion, I think they conceal the charm of the original wood windows.
I agree.
You don't see them at all.
Right.
I agree.
I agree with you. It takes a bit more maintenance on caulking and painting. But I'm with you. I think it just gives the house some dimension that if you have the storm windows on the outside, you'll never get. But today, I was thinking when you were talking, today I happened to be at my girlfriend's house on 2nd Avenue, Rudy Jordan's, and there's probably, I don't know, maybe 10 different styles of windows easily downstairs. And I was just thinking as I was walking through, oh, how spectacular is this? That, you know, this house has had so many changes and so many kinds of windows. And it made me, who lives in a 1980s house, feel a bit jealous. So I don't think getting all the windows the same would actually do for you what you're wanting. I do agree with you about the storm windows, and of course modern day windows replace if there's
the aluminum. Ones on the far end of the house.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
And you are correct, that used to be a garage.
Yeah. Any other comments?
If you have glass that's wavy in one of the sashes and not in the other, and you want them to match, you can buy restoration glass today that will closely approximate what the other looks like.
Okay. All right.
and a good example, I think, of restoring windows and what an effective end result can turn out would be the house on Church Street across mm-hmm. from the courthouse. I forget what number that is, but I couldn't believe it. We were given an opportunity to walk through after they had done restored the windows, and sure enough, it was amazing.
It's a little Airbnb with a colored door.
And Ms. Marquardt, I can find that address for Ms. Kane. Mm-hmm. I do want to share that the owner of that building sent me an email after the fact saying that she was unhappy at first that she had to keep some of those windows, but in retrospect was very thankful that she was requested to do so, and add so much more charm to her property. So I can get that information for Ms. Kane, certainly. But I do want to recap so that's clear for Ms. Kane and everyone here that the recommendation, as I've heard it, is that the vinyl windows located here would be supported to be replaced with a window unit that is comparable in material and profile to those existing on the same elevation. That it would not necessarily be appropriate to replace this divided light window if that is a wood window and of historic value. I don't have information on that specifically here. I might need to look at it myself, but having changes over time become historic in their own right. And then replacing any other window that is non-historic could be appropriate, but it appears that most all of these are, with the exception of those two at the garage, which would make sense because it wasn't filled over time. There are opportunities to utilize interior or exterior storms. The storms that are on there currently are supported to be removed. That would not require Historic Zoning Commission review. The applicant could go ahead and remove those if she desires to do so. In that, you know, I'm a resource. I have a lot of information I can share with you on storm windows, on replacement windows, on repairing and maintaining existing windows. So I'm happy to meet with you and talk through that more if that's something that you'd like to do. But ultimately, the commission would need to approve replacing any of the windows, even the vinyl here. Did I miss anything?
Somewhat. It seems like that we would have a possibility for a mix of replacement and repair in the end, which we have done before.
Absolutely. That is what is typical that the commission approves, is that there's a lot of maintaining and repairing, and that the ones that aren't historic or beyond repair could be replaced. But we don't have enough information from the architect to be able to substantiate non-repair. If non-repair is something that your architect feels strongly about, then we certainly would love to see that information.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
We'll be back in touch to give you more information and move forward. It's so nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you too.
Okay, we've got built into our agenda a 10-minute break, and we're at that stage, and we're doing pretty well, gang.
Great.
Time-wise, so we've got it's 10 minutes to 6, and let's resume at 6 o'clock. Kelly, do we need to give a signal to... There, all right, we're good. We're going to reconvene then.
I can make a quick announcement that the heat has been adjusted, so it's not heat anymore. So it should cool off here momentarily. Thank you all for your comments on that.
I thought it was just me. All right. Discussion of new construction accessory at 810 West Main Street. Mr. McCrary.
We have him for the next two items.
Please do.
Hello, how are you all?
We're fine, welcome.
Okay, do I need to hit, we're good, with green button, green light's on. So this first one is, we're talking about putting an addition on an accessory structure that's already existing at the back of the 810 West Main project. You can kind of see in that photo, that's the current state of the garage. It's really just a small one-car garage, wood clapboard siding, asphalt roof. So what we want to do is add about a 250 square foot addition onto it, really just to make it so that it's more usable for the owner to have.
And I think we reviewed last month the gate.
We did. I don't think, nothing's really changed on the gate. I think we've got some more information about the easement. I think that was a question the city had is whether the easement was his city property or was it whether it was part of the adjacent landowner. And so we've got some answers for that that we'll include with the HCC submission, but really right now I want to just talk about the addition to the accessory structure. So what we're planning to do is add about a 10 by 15 addition onto the accessory structure, which itself is 20 by 12. And so that's the footprint you can see right there. We're gonna have French door on the front and some additional windows and things. The next slide will show the elevations.
And Ben, just to clarify, you said French doors on the front. Do you mean
yes,
here?
Right there, the smaller doors. The existing garage doors are those outswing like that.
Okay.
We will keep that look. Whether it will be rebuilding them, we'll probably need to rehabilitate them some or potentially rebuild them. But we'll keep that look, and then we're going to add. Some stuff on there. And I think, Amanda, I might have sent you a revised version of that shows some more windows.
Did you send it today?
No, I would have sent it on probably late last week.
I am not sure. I can look. Just a moment.
Sure.
I see an email from you from Tuesday about the easement and then information today about the easement, but I don't have anything revised. So, sorry.
That's okay. Well, regardless.
So can you just explain where you would like additional windows?
So the addition windows would be on the bottom elevation. On either side of the French door, we would add, and again, all of that is an addition, right? There is no extra gable coming off this way right now, so we're adding that piece. The French doors are new. To either left and right of those, we would be adding a window to that, and then up on the carriage front elevation, on the long side of the addition, we're going to add three windows to that location.
Can you talk a little bit more about the window dimension?
The style of the window. Mm-hmm. I think they're probably going to be around a little less than 3 feet wide and a little less than 5 feet tall.
Individual windows or one?
They will be three individual windows ganged together with about a 3-inch thick mold between the windows themselves.
Okay.
And then they'll have trim work around them to match or be consistent with the house and the rest of the existing trim on the building. They'll also probably, we're looking at a 3-over-1 style, which is what's already in the house itself, just to try to tie those two together. So, and they'll be double hung as well. And then the windows on either side of the front door will also be about that same size. And they would have complementary trim around them as well. And 3-over-1 type of look. And I apologize that that's not showing up right now. It is, I can tell you, let's see. It's going to be 10 feet long.
It's 10 feet wide, yes.
10 feet wide, the wall. So the windows are actually, I think they're probably 2 foot six. We'll say they're 2 foot six. So there's going to be about 18 inches on either side of the window bank between the corner and the other corner. So it's going to fill up most of that elevation. But again, it's a kind of a garage accessory structure. It's not looking towards the house. It's looking, again, in the backyard. So we're trying to add a lot of natural light. This may become some sort of a studio space for the owner where they can use that as well.
Mr. Roberts, may I make some comments, please?
Yeah.
Okay. So I really appreciate this metal. I'm sorry, too, that I can't show you the proposed windows. I don't know what happened there. But I will say that the guidelines do not specifically specify whether or not enclosed additions for principal or accessory structures need to be 50% or less. I would say in this circumstance with accessory structures that it has been common that the commission has approved larger than 50% additions to accessory structures if they maintain the integrity of the original structure. And of course, there are many applications that we have received to request demolition of accessory structures. So any application to maintain a historic accessory structure and modify it to meet some modern convenience would be absolutely ideal. So I very much support of the application as far as the addition goes. I too do have some concerns about the spacing of the proposed windows on the front facade that would be facing the driveway. I understand that it is not facing street views, but it's not necessarily typical of an accessory structure to have so much glazing. I'd like to see a little bit more of a simple window configuration on the front facade of an accessory structure. Now, that since this side faces interior to the property and is not from view sheds from that easement, I think there is a little bit more leniency here. So maybe having more glazing showing to the interior would be appropriate, but perhaps a more historically typical window configuration would be more appropriate on this facade. Thank you.
That's fine. The other one that showed the measurements, the setback measurement, yeah, that'd be great. Yeah, that's perfect. So my question is, obviously the addition accounts for the side setback, which the original structure doesn't, presumably is grandfathered. So for staff, I would like to know, at what point is the addition such that you're outside of the grandfathering? Because I realize in the where the addition's coming out, they're adjusting the setback there, but the rest of the structure is still hugged up against the property
That's
line.
That's an excellent question, Mr. Denton, and thank you for bringing that up so that I can address it. So we have a lot of historic outbuildings that do not like to change their location based on modern zoning. So we like to stay, they like to stay in place, and we like them to stay in place. And so what we find is that as times change and the community visions and values change, that we'll have outbuildings that don't meet the zoning ordinance requirements for rear or side yard setbacks. Sometimes accessory structures are sitting in other people's yards partially. So what the interpretation is from our zoning administration office is that the building is non-conforming and that it is sitting within the rear yard setback. However, any improvements made to it just cannot increase the non-conformity. So because the addition's proposed to be in place, it's 5 feet off the side yard property line, it's not increasing that nonconformity.
So you could technically take a one-car, I mean, I know we don't have the space for it here, but you could technically take a one-car garage that is not in conformity with the current setbacks and increase that to a, you could make such dramatic changes that you could increase it to a three-car garage, so long as you were, the new addition portion is maintaining the current setback requirements, it wouldn't.
I would say that's the case more likely than not for anywhere outside the historic district. For the historic district, it's probably not likely that the commission, based on other guidelines, would approve that dramatic of a change, but theoretically, yes.
Okay, that's surprising.
Ms. Stannenfelser, do you agree? Okay.
Anything else?
Amanda, if you by chance just got an email from me that would have the updated drawings in it. Mm-hmm. So that's where you can see that's the size of the windows that are proposed. We're really just matching kind of the window style that's on the existing house already. And then
I do agree that having grouped windows is very craftsman minded. This is a Tudor house. I'd love feedback on whether or not you would see that. I think that the existing house might have grouped windows on the front. Yes.
Mr. Chair, I agree with what the staff's first reaction was, that the one window keeps it looking like a garage.
Could it be larger than one of those?
It could.
Okay.
Could you clarify, you're saying you would look to see just a single window?
Single window.
When you get the three windows that match the house, it makes it look more like it's like some kind of a guest cottage or something instead of a garage. And the one window, it is pretty often that you do see one window in a garage.
That's true.
Okay, anything else from anybody? Okay, I think we're good on this one. We'll go to the next one.
Okay.
And this is, where are we? Alterations, drive aisle fencing and addition at 211 Second Avenue South.
We got another garage for you. So.
Which we've already approved removing.
That is correct. Mm-hmm. We do not have to discuss whether we can.
We don't have to go through that again.
Right. This is just what's going to go back.
That's right.
So.
Okay. So I'm sorry. I just want to clarify that item number 8. There's a mistake on the chair agenda. It is for consideration new construction at 211 Second Avenue South.
Okay. I didn't think that looked right. All right.
So we
go
are
ahead.
Ready? Okay. So this is the existing house.
Right.
You can see that. It's a historic home. And would you like a history of what the house is to give you a reference point of kind of where it's come from, or just want me to dive in?
I think we've got that.
Okay.
I think we know. Everybody's familiar with that particular house. So I think just talk about
the accessory
proposing.
Structure. All right, so what we're proposing is a one-car garage accessory structure located to the rear of the house. The existing accessory structure was not in compliance with, it was actually over the property line, and it's a lot of disrepair, so taking that down. We've moved this one so that it is in, you know, it's 5 feet off of the property line, and then we've created it to have the one-car garage as well as some storage places for trash, as well as some uses for the homeowner themselves to keep their lawn equipment and things like that. Another piece of this is we're looking to add a chimney and outdoor fireplace on the yard side of the structure. I think one thing that's very important to note about this is based on where this building is going to be placed behind the house, it will not be, that chimney and everything will not be visible from the street. If you look at either A001 or A101 would probably be a good one to look at, Amanda, or even that one's fine. If you zoom in there, you can kind of see that little diagonal dash line is the new structure, and then the house and the porch and everything else, as well as the trees that are there, really are going to block the chimney from the road. As you know, there's also at the adjacent property, there's a small little stone house that's kind of creates a very narrow view shed into the backyard of this property. So it's a single story, kind of two cross gables is what the design of the garage is going to look like. And then, looking at some carriage style doors for the garage doors itself. two-panel door for the exterior there from what you would see, and then similar detailing to the house itself as far as horizontal siding, 5-inch exposure, and things like that in the details. We've got a little outdoor kind of storage area for the trash recycling in the bottom left image that you can see right there, And it'll be kind of a sliding type of barn door that'll have a similar style to the what you would normally see for a door on an older structure like this. So we've tried to make things that are, make the structure complementary to what's existing in the house, but not try to mimic all the historic detail that's on the existing house.
Okay, staff, comments?
Yes, thank you for the 3D renderings. Those are very helpful in analyzing this proposal. Staff actually only has one issue, and that is with the chimney fireplace. Chimneys are not used typically in historic equivalents of accessory structures, and it may compete with the chimney on the principal building, especially since it is outward facing. But staff would support removing it from the accessory structure and making it freestanding instead.
Okay, committee, comments?
Well, I told y'all earlier I was at Rudy's today, which is one door down. So I walked over there because they were in the yard. I just don't think you're going to see it. And we, just for consistency, approved an attached chimney next door that is very oversized. So because of where it's located and not being able to see it, I could support this.
The chimney?
I could.
Mm-hmm. Any comments on the building aside from that?
No. I mean, I don't think staff even has, no one.
Yeah. You're right.
I concur.
Okay, Ken. Anybody else? Okay, done.
Jimmy, I just want to say for the record that the one next door that Ms. Pierce noted was not, it's not approved on an accessory structure, it's approved on the principal structure.
On the principal, but yes. The same type of thing.
Yes, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing you just got to say about this house, John and his wife Carol bought it. At one time, it was a storage and gravel storage for the city of Franklin.
How about that?
It is a beautiful house.
It's a beautiful house.
Mm-hmm. All right, there's okay. Another part of this as well. That is the first part, the accessory structure. The other piece that we wanted to discuss is the potential addition of a porte cochere off the side of the house.
I don't have that on the plan set.
You don't have that in the...
That was not given to me as part of the submittal.
Isn't it in the submittal? No?
No, and it's not advertised for discussion.
Well, then I guess we won't be discussing that at this point.
I don't see anything on here for that.
Sorry. I don't have it.
Okay, we're ready for the next one. New construction, principal and accessory at 185 Splendor Ridge Drive. Chad Gore.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I brought paper, but I don't know if you guys want it or not.
Sure.
Everybody loves. I have something to flip through.
That's fine. Thank you, sir.
I feel like I should have a lot of coffee.
Thank you. Well, I could think of something else at this point. A glass of wine. Yeah, pizza.
All right, we are working our way down the street. We're lot 15. This footprint And the way it's sited on the lot is very similar to the great majority of the rest of the ones that we've designed and that you all have approved up until now. Garage pushed about as far back as we can get it, with the driveway slipping by one side there. Our lot coverage right now is calculated just under 40%, as has been the previous 13 or so. I guess 12, right? I am now on page 4, which is the kind of front elevation rendering. We have a Tudor-ish kind of elevation. And massing, this is somewhat similar to Lot 3. Lot 3 was a more Victorian kind of almost Carpenter Gothic feel to it. This one's a little more Tudor detailing. It'll be mostly brick with some of the half-timbering kind of treatments in the gables. And I have a pergola on the front over the front porch to help give that some dimension. And a cantilevered bay window on the front. And last week we had some discussion about how to resolve the bay on lot 14 and worked with staff to work all that out. And since we, extenuating circumstances, didn't allow us to do a cantilevered bay on that one, we thought, well, we've got an opportunity right next door to do a cantilevered bay. So able to work that one in on this one, on this submittal. Contextual images a few pages in as well, so you can see the other nearby houses that have been approved. There is nothing submitted yet for lot 16, but we just kind of have a gray square over there. I can't think of anything else exceptional to this lot versus the other previous ones, but as usual, I'm happy to answer any questions you have.
Staff, you got any comments?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Gore. So the height and massing are keeping in with the guidelines and are typical for this development. One thing that staff wants to note is that the left and right elevations, there's a portion of the second story with lap siding while the lower portion has brick. And staff would just recommend changing this to be lap all the way down. This is consistent with something that was approved before on another lot. We would also recommend adding either a window or a brick inlay to represent a window on the left elevation towards the front. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then because it is 39.7% building coverage, staff will have to recommend against the proposal.
Mr. Chair, one comment. I have no issue with making all of that siding past the main gable. I would, just as a reminder though, we talked some in previous meetings about other lots that to try to make some effort that the back half of all these houses doesn't look all exactly the same. And so we've treated that, the back half of houses a little bit differently materially, and this is just one other way to treat it. But if the preference is for it to be all siding, I don't have an issue.
Mr. Chair, I just, you know, I'm famous for pulling up pictures. I just pulled up a picture of a Tudor house, and I would ask staff, could another option be, you know, on the front gable, you've got what material? On the front, over the bay window. Okay, well, what would happen if that panel material was where the wood is now and came all the way forward to I don't know the right words, all the way forward there, Ken?
Within the cable?
Mm-hmm. But
hey,
You're saying on the side elevation?
Yes, sir. It's typical of it.
On the left? On the left elevation?
If you didn't want, if you said you didn't want them all to look the same.
Wait a minute. You're talking, you started talking about the front and now we're on the left?
Well, the front is what you would copy on the side.
Ah, and so, okay. Mary, if I may, you're talking about everything. Let's talk about the front half of the left elevation?
Yes.
Okay. And everything all the way down to the cornice level of that main gable being treated with that same half timbering kind of look.
That's what I'm asking. I mean, I'm finding it on the internet.
I think you could, but I would be cautious of doing that with the brick gable being right adjacent to it on the front and having the half timbering on the side of that gable. It's going to look like there are two parts, different parts of the same.
That's why it won't do. Okay.
Right.
Was that referring to the section between the two masses?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I thought, that would be siding down to the water table in that area.
And this could be siding or brick, too, as long as the brick is exposed.
Yeah, that'll do it, too.
As long as the chimney is actually extruded and exposed.
Gotcha. That would do it, too.
I think I would prefer the lap siding. Now, you know, one way to do it might be to have lap siding all the way to the foundation, just in that middle section.
Right.
And then have brick on the lower half and siding on the upper half and on the back.
Yeah.
That might help set up, you know, sections, I guess, of them. No.
I'm saying you'd have to do it.
Okay, everyone's clear on that? The chimney's not proposed to be extruded. It's proposed to die into the material on the actual body of the house.
I think we could, though. I mean, if that's an issue.
I mean, just take it out a course of brick.
Yeah, take it out four to 6 inches.
On the two-story, with the gable and the chimney,
only to make it look a little different than the other ones that are of similar massing.
Are there any others that've been approved like that?
Yes, I don't remember which lot. Maybe six.
Yeah, we did one of them. I remember.
I think there's been a couple. I don't remember exactly which lots they were.
My comment has to do with the pergola.
Okay.
So I don't think any other houses have been approved with a pergola on the front porch.
One, it was lot six. Yeah. I'm almost certain it was lot six. As you know, I'm bumped right up against my coverage limits, and that's sort of a trick of the...
I see.
If it were a covered porch, I would then be over 40% coverage. If it had a roof on it.
It's just a non-traditional... non-traditional way to do your porch, especially on the front.
Yeah, maybe so.
But it's covered at the door.
It is covered at the door.
Staff does support the pergola, and we have approved these in other infill lots.
Good. Any other comments? All right, we're good. Thank you, Chad.
Just to recap, so siding... Actually, I'm not actually sure where the siding. We have agreed to do the siding all the way down. If someone can explain that.
Let me recap.
Yes.
So what staff has heard is that on the left elevation, the recommendation would be to use siding all the way down on the quote-unquote connector piece between the two gables. And that this could be, it could be all siding, all brick, or as proposed, as long as the chimney is extruded, so it is historically typical that it doesn't die into the cladding of the building. Is that correct? Okay, and now on the right side, just to be clear too, there are similar conditions. I want to make sure we're all on the same page here. Oops. Again, the file is just very big, sorry. What would be the recommendation of the DRC for this one? Would this all be siding on this middle section before the garage? And I'd love the applicant to speak a little bit more about this How does this plane fall in relation to this bay here?
It's easiest to see on the first floor plan. Or a roof plan would be fine too, either one.
Sure.
You see the little part that's kind of tucked in the elbow there. That's the part that's treated with siding.
Okay. Thank you. So any comments from the DRC on the cladding for the right side?
That being the case, I'll probably just carry this. It'll probably all be siding on the other side as well.
Anything else from anyone? Staff, you good?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Chad.
All right, discussion of demolition and new construction at 328 Franklin Road.
Sean, are those the same? Is that the same information you gave me? Okay,
We've seen it. You can put it up on the screen.
Okay.
Right? I think we're good.
You may want to save those for the application. Okay.
Yep.
You
aren't
going to change anything?
It's nice to see you. Hey, Andrew, can you please turn on the button on your microphone, please? It'll have a green light. Okay,
yep,
thanks.
You're good. So, the proposed plans are somewhere.
There are three lots. Is that what I heard? You're under contract three lots or two lots?
It's three lots.
Okay, okay, that's fine.
And combining into one, yeah.
Was originally Howard Hill owned that? All that farm, my wife, Clena, is the granddaughter to Mr. Hill. And when we saw that come on the market, she wanted, everything else was gone, she wanted a chance to see if we could get that and build on that. And it's platted for three lots, but like Andrew said, we don't plan on building three separate houses on that. We want to build one home.
Okay.
Thank you very much. We're looking at the plan right now, so we can elaborate a little bit more on the lots. If you'll give us just a moment. To give you some context reference, the church is located to the right of this. The church on Franklin Road, and to the left is the Wyatt Hall property. So, you know, Wyatt Hall has a big field to the left, or to the right of the house, as you view it from Franklin Road. That big field is to the left of this property here.
If you're facing it.
If you're facing it. I'll pull up the street view so you can see that as well.
Yeah. May we ask what the subdivision name is?
What's that?
Is there a subdivision name?
It's Howard Hill.
Howard Hill. We just need to do some additional research because it doesn't show up on our maps for some reason.
So you're aware this is the church property. Here to the right. This is the subject property. It's across from Harlan Stell Farm. And then when you see the fence is the Wyatt Hall property. There's a lot of open space, and then there's a driveway that allows you to enter the site to the house. So it's a very substantial lot on this side, it's open space. So is everyone clear on the location? Yes? Okay. Okay, so the proposal is to demolish the existing structure and to construct in its stead a new structure. I believe everyone has seen the plans. It is a suburban farmhouse style, a little indicative of what you would see at Harlan Stell Manor. I say that with utmost respect. I don't mean
which
that.
It's
indicative of what you see at Harlan Stell Manor. Harlan Stell Manor is beloved infill development, and it's been used as context reference for other developments proposed in this corridor. So the proposal is to do something similar to that. I did ask Mr. Pockrent and others who have expressed interest in this property to consult the DRC, because demolition and window replacement, as we all know, take a lot of time and discussion. And this is a structure that is of a vintage. I believe the assessor dates it to 1952. With that, it is almost 70 years old, which meets the federal potential standards for a historic structure. Not all old structures are historic, but the federal government, specifically the National Park Service through the Secretary of Interior, does recommend that buildings over 50 years in age be evaluated for historic status. So in reviewing the context, you see that, you know, Franklin Road has a lot of variety. It's very open on this northern part. As you go south, you see a mix. You see a lot of ranch style structures that have been built in over time, a lot dating to the 50s and 60s. And while some of those are in the historic district, others aren't, recommendation of staff would be that as an evolving architectural style that shows the changes over time to architectural trends in the United States and also here in Franklin, and of an age that has historic significance, it would be recommended that the commission preserve and maintain minimal traditional and ranch style structures such as this one. Thank you.
Okay, comments?
Well, the idea that you are taking three lots and keeping it as one big one,
yes, ma'am,
of course, is very appealing to those of us who enjoy, you know, the pristine nature of the view. Ranch style homes, I believe, just don't get a whole lot of respect. And when it comes to demolition, this commission is very hesitant to grant a demolition without a lot of evidence that the conditions are dangerous, or that the condition of the place itself has reached a point of no return. Have you ever considered adding on to this little ranch home?
We have not.
Mm-hmm.
And what my wife brought up to me was that, so her grandmother and grandfather owned that house on the hill, bought by the same company. They bought that land, and they bought what we have a contract on. That house was built the very same time that this house was built. And they demoed that, which we didn't know why, but they did. We had been in that house, and it was pretty sound. So we thought that if that was okay, that there was a chance we could get this okay.
Can you help me understand where the three lots are located on this parcel?
Okay.
So is the home straddling three? Oh, straddling
one.
Okay.
So it's one, and then next is two, and then the other is three, going across that way. So one, two, three. That house is built on one,
So there are two lots that are platted that are not, of course, built on.
Okay.
So that's the three lots there. Then there's four, five, and six, which is church property now, mm-hmm. that was also platted at the same time.
Okay.
And what was the name of that subdivision?
Howard Hill Subdivision.
Howard. You Hill, but I'm not Howard.
So all that farm behind it is now Hill Estates. They own all of that. So.
Okay. So the home is not straddling any of the lots. It's on its own lot.
I believe it is.
Okay.
The mission of the Historic Zoning Commission is to make determinations on historic property status. We do not have a national registered district within this corridor. It is a local district, so we don't have an official listing, contributing versus non-contributing structures, as we would for a national registered listed district like Hendryville or downtown. But we do, as part of our national register listing updates, change periods of significance, as advised by our consultants and our state historic preservation office, to reflect the changing architectural trends over time. This historic corridor has evolved significantly over time, and as things change over time, they gain historic significance. And so because this is not just a single minimal traditional home on Franklin Road that's sort of an anomaly, we have a number of these types of homes heading south toward downtown. It would be suggested that it be considered by the commission as is evolving over time. I don't remember exactly when the demolition request came in for the property on the hill, but I can look into that. I believe that was several years back. Because properties are considered potentially historic at a 50-year age mark, it may be that it was straddling that time, and it was something that the commission felt comfortable with, given that it was not quite as old. But I would have to pull those records up.
I wish you would pull those records up. I don't ever remember in the last 8 years that we approved that demolition. It may have been.
I can certainly pull that up, and I wasn't prepared to speak to that.
Well, I wasn't either. I didn't know they were all connected.
But as Ms. Marquardt had pointed out, there are criteria for demolition that the commission considers, and it's not all historic versus non-historic.
No.
There are criteria about economic hardship for structural instability. So it may be that one of those criteria was determined to be met by the commission. I'd have to pull those records.
Well, Mr. Chair, it's compelling to me that it would be a large lot, which it is now, and that would be preserved. But I don't understand how, if we say this house could be demolished, that there's any assurance. I mean, if you know something happens to you tomorrow, that there's any assurance how that would go.
Well, and if it's truly located on one of three lots that is that mm-hmm. what people today perceive to be a parcel, but mm-hmm. it's actually three separate parcels, there's nothing to prohibit the owner from building on the other
unless
two lots.
It was rezoned to one lot. I guess.
Well,
I'm asking.
Consolidated.
That's a question.
That's not what Josh is. I think you're saying there's nothing to preclude him from building the house.
Two more
on
homes.
Two more lots. Or, on the other two lots.
Or regardless of what happens with the current home, whether it's permitted to be demolished or not, I wouldn't think there'd mm-hmm. be anything precluding development of the other two existing lots if they are truly a subdivision in Franklin. It's already been subdivided. In
if they are subdivided, then you are absolutely correct. Yes.
So that the decision about demolition, like the comfort that this is one large lot, if it's already three lots, it's already three lots.
So the demolition
is
cannot
totally
be based on the idea that you're getting you're saving some of the street view shed on Hill on Franklin Road.
Right. I think that's right. I mean, if those are truly three separate
subdivided lots.
Well, what if the applicant asked for a rezoning to one lot?
I defer to staff on that. I don't know that it has to be a rezoning. It could just be a consolidation.
A consolidation, yeah.
You can replat it.
I can clarify. If there are three lots here, and our records are not showing that there are, so we need to do more research on the city and for that. But essentially, if there are three lots here, as Mr. Denton noted, nothing would preclude the applicant from seeking approval to build on the other two lots, assuming the Historic Zoning Commission approves the plans. It would not preclude the applicant from seeking alterations to the existing structure on the single property there, which he's doing now. The only way to ensure that no other buildings are constructed would be that there was a consolidation of the lot, and that would not be a contingency of approval. That would be something that the applicant could pursue in order to ensure that it's one lot in perpetuity, but well, not in perpetuity, but for the time being.
But right now we're being asked to consider tearing down this house in order to build the new house on that area of land, whether it's one lot, three lots, two lots, or whatever.
Yes.
I mean, that's the request before us.
Yes, and so any new build would have to honor the existing lot lines, yes.
Okay, so, I mean, I think we're going to have some pushback on just tearing down the house.
Yes.
That's where I'm coming from. Mm-hmm. But that,
yes.
But there's, at this juncture, so, and I do want to know what happened on that thing on top of the hill. Mm-hmm. That's to that with house that was up there.
It's like
that just went away.
With the information we have,
yeah,
there'd be pushback.
So, are there any other comments on this right now?
So, are you saying that the commission is against demolition?
Based on what we see right now, to tear down a house in order to build a new house. That's what I'm hearing. That's what's before us.
And I would concur with my fellow commissioners on that. You know, there was a time, having grown up and being, we get a certain age, you've seen a lot of ranch style houses and probably grown up in them. And you may not have actually seen the value. But as I've gotten older and been on the commission and realize that new generations are finding mid-century modern very attractive, that I've become more of a preservation of those, especially in this view shed.
All right, anything else? Thank you. All right, last but not least, discussion of new construction, principal and accessory at 119 Winslow Road. I think we've seen this man with this family before.
Hello, everybody. This
Hello.
Michael Katsatis, MK Studio. Let me give this to Amanda real quick.
So I would like to provide a little bit of information to help clarify what Mr. Kasadish has asked me to do. So you'll see on the presentation that was provided to you that the front door is proposed to be situated in a way that it's not on the front facade. You would not actually see it if you're standing in vantages directly in front of the house. I'd ask Mr. Kasadis to seek an interpretation from the zoning administrator about that appropriateness in light of zoning regulations, which state that the front entrance must be displayed prominently on a front facade. And based on the interpretation, Mr. Kasadis is seeking to show you a slightly revised version of what you received earlier. So I'm going to pull that up now.
Amanda, if you want to show
has
everybody seen the 3D drive-by?
Yeah, it's great. It's great, yes.
Well, we're going to change it a little bit. On the front stoop.
Which file?
It says front door.
Okay.
You did a 3D special thing that was really pretty good.
Thank you.
We love it.
You could tell a lot from that.
Well, I try to do the streetscape. I try to add the the tall and skinny townhomes on the right side. So, so you want to do that?
Is this how you'd like me to start?
Well, I was going to hit that at the end, but
okay.
I can go in whatever order you choose. You want me to start at the beginning?
Let's, should we just do the as presented, as submitted originally?
Okay. So I did add this slide in. I have the most awesome art skills, as you can see. But I wanted to give you some sort of sense of exactly where this lot is in relation to the existing construction. So just to clarify and remind everyone, this existing building that has been subdivided so that the existing garage is no longer on the same property. The existing garage is on a neighboring property, and the property we're discussing today is on the other side of that. So 1, 2, 3. Okay, is everyone clear?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. The original elevation, of course, the main elevation, is based loosely on a kind of an English Tudor Revival cottage architecture. It does have a little whimsical and storybook styling. It combines kind of the pure Tudor architecture with some restrained modern elements as well. So it fuses the uncluttered space with the detailing that creates that vision that Danny and Teresa Anderson wanted for their home. I know it has become a cliche, but essentially we wanted the home to look like a cottage that has withstood the time, the test of time, but has been updated with a little small fresh perspective. The 1.5 story design borrows heavily from the Tudor Revival style through its large, steep gable form, the exposed, decorative, scrolled, 2-foot deep overhangs. If we can zoom in a little bit, just I want you to kind of appreciate the styling of, it's not just the pure, simple rafter tail, exposed rafter tail. It has some scrollings. So the other element that even with a new front facing door that we're going to try to keep is that feathered, that siding that kind of covers the stone underneath it on that siding. We'll look at that in just a minute.
So, Michael, I really want to encourage, just for the sake of lessening any confusion, that we really only reference sure. what you'd like to propose. Well, so is it okay if we just reference
this?
Yeah,
let's look at that.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. I just don't want there to be any confusion by anyone watching.
And if you want hard copies of this, I do have some extra hard copies. But now the front door is facing Winslow. Originally, it was a side entry. So with the approach down Winslow Road from Franklin Road, and it's similar to some adjacent homes, neighboring homes, they have their doors to the side. And I was trying to pay homage to that, but zoning thought otherwise. So we're going to confirm with that and add that door to the front. Above the front door, we're still keeping that swooping roof with that window above that door in that loft area, kind of penetrating that mass. And of course, the piercing dormer above the triple corner window.
Can I have a paper copy? What's this new version?
Me one, two. Yeah.
Same here.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Michael. I think sometimes with new submittals that it's harder for the commissioners to see them on the screen. So.
Oh, absolutely.
Thank
That's
you.
Why I brought it.
Yeah, thank you.
zoning just made me aware of this Friday, so.
I got this. Thank you.
So part of this revision also, it just, it does address the front of the house a little better. I will incorporate kind of a wraparound stair waterfall treatment for the stoop. Do you want to describe anything on the floor plan, perhaps?
I think I would recommend that we talk a little bit about the site plan, how much percentage of the lot the proposal takes up, and your massing, your scale, your setbacks, things like that.
The lot coverage, it is over 35%. So we are right now at 35.5%. So we're over a half of a percentage, or 61 square feet. As far as the LSA, do we need to get into those numbers?
No, I would focus on your style, which you have done, your scale. We could talk about the accessory structure relationship to the house.
Yes, so we do have an accessory building with a two-car garage, an art studio that's connected to the primary structure with a breezeway. We are proposing to have a pool on that, in that courtyard. As you see, it will be fenced around that area, tying in the master bedroom wing, and then on the back of the carriage garage. Another item that zoning, I requested, and I think zoning is asking historical, you guys, your recommendations as far as the transitional features of the windows at the art studio in the back of the carriage garage.
So let's go ahead, and I know sometimes it's a little less intuitive with new construction, but I have these renderings up, and I know this is something that is no longer meeting the proposed conditions, but we'll go to the sides and let me see, this is the left elevation, and you can see the rear accessory structure is what face internal to the lot where the pool is proposed to be. The breezeway connector between. This is a rendering that shows that side. Again, the front has been adjusted.
Correct. Not on the 3D model yet, but
right.
You can see that transition between the stone and the siding with that mm-hmm. flared out look, bringing the siding to cover
where's
that stone,
the stone
below.
And where's the siding?
So the stone
the
is
stone,
here.
Go ahead.
The stone's here and the siding is above. There's a little wider reveal here and then tighter above. So you can see it transitions at the floor level.
So the house is stone?
The house is supposed to be stone and siding, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
Okay.
On the front facade, you can see the second or the story and a half portion of the structure is siding, lap siding. The accessory building is all lap siding.
Right, here is the right side elevation. I'd love Michael to talk a little bit more about the fenestration choices, namely the window sizing and locations,
sure.
And then also the trellis area.
So we also wanted to be a little playful with the design. So we introduced that circular or round window underneath that landing that's in the stairs. In that space that Amanda was pointing to, that's a kind of a grand foyer. We'll have our grand piano in there. So it's a music room, a foyer, a connector going upstairs. So those three windows are kind of clear story. Wrapping around with along with the stairs that are leading up. So that round window, I don't know if you noticed, but on that 3D model, if you were standing at the front door, you could see that round window going beyond. So as far as the arbor or the garden arbor with the open trellis, that was another way of kind of grounding the facade, giving it a different mass and scale. You look at the front elevation. So perhaps we can grow some wisteria or something growy and hanging from that trellis as well. And on the left side, on the opposite side of the arbor, we'll have that flared out or swooping wing wall. And behind that wing wall, we'll have the HVAC unit. So that's going to be hidden as well. Mm.
So, Michael, just to clarify, you mean right here on the
yes,
on the left elevation of the house?
Okay. Correct. So those three windows, as you can see on that view right there, it's the three windows that are three windows with three transoms that are in question from zoning as far as does it meet the transitional features of the neighborhood. So.
And I can comment a little bit more to that. The zoning ordinance has what we call transitional features for either non-residential or residential properties. For residential, the zoning ordinance states that windows should be placed in such a way that they do not impede on the privacy of you know adjoining properties. Usually when these requests come in, they are specific to accessory structures because they're located, you know, further back on the property. In this case, I did advise Mr. Casadas to ask zoning for an interpretation because these are much larger windows, taller windows than what you typically see on the back of a historic structure. I think that this one's being designed to meet the requirements of the accessory dwelling because of its size. And in that case, it does state that they need to be more diminutive. Victoria can speak a little bit more to transitional features than I because she reviews those more than I do. But I did not receive Shanna's response, or maybe I did and I just don't remember. But you know, the zoning would dictate that, you know, there may need to be smaller windows. So we can get an interpretation. Did Shanna ask that the Historic Zoning Commission provide
yeah,
that?
Yeah, what's your feedback on those windows?
Okay, well, staff's recommendation would be that, you know, depending on how close they are to the property line or how much screening is provided, that would be maintained in perpetuity, that they may need to be not as tall to look into adjoining properties. But I would need more information on that to be able to clarify to you today.
We also do, we have some images of that adjacent home in the back. If you look at, actually on that thumb drive, Amanda, there's a PDF file with neighboring homes perhaps, or? Site images and homes. And if you scroll down a little bit, that picture to the right, that's the home to the rear of this property.
How far off the property line is your garage proposed to be situated? And is the do you know if the gate is representative of the property line?
I'm not aware, but it's at 10 feet.
Okay.
Our accessory building is at 10 feet.
Okay.
Can I ask a question?
No,
sorry.
We will also have a fence, because of the pool, we will have a fence around it, wrapping around those three windows in the art studio as well.
Okay. Michael, do you have any additional comments you want to make?
No, I think we're open to you.
Josh, did you have a question just for orientation? Because I still need to make comments.
Sure. Well, it was on that window.
Okay, sure.
So just if you could weigh in as to how that would be treated differently than the accessory dwelling or the garage addition we saw earlier where the size of the windows was an issue. If you could just weigh in on that.
Sure. So historically, typical, you know, accessory structures would not have as much glazing as you're seeing on the proposal today, certainly.
Okay.
The zoning ordinance does make its standards specific to concerns that had been raised by the community about, you know, the use of accessory dwellings and privacy potential issues. So they're standards that are the same, but for different reasons. So as the guidelines would read, that it would be encouraged that they would be smaller. So that might be the reason that zoning is asking for your input, given that it is in the historic district.
Okay. Sorry to interrupt.
Okay, we ready for us to speak, Amanda?
Oh. I'm sorry?
Is it our turn now?
I would like to give comments.
Okay, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
I've been trying to help Michael through.
That's fine.
So I wanted to say that I appreciate Michael and his clients, the Andersons, meeting with me virtually to discuss the proposal a couple of weeks ago. I think that was very helpful for them and myself as well as Victoria. That they have responded to some of the items I had pointed out. I've just received the revised proposal that you're seeing as you've seen it. So I don't have a lot of comments prepared for that, but I will say that, you know, this style is a little higher style than what you would see for a Tudor revival. As Michael explained, it has a little bit more cottage inspiration, more fairy tale type inspiration. It was something that, you know, I stated to the applicant that the important thing for infill construction and truly infill construction, where you are relating to properties on, you know, either side of you, across the street from you, is that you blend in so it settles, so that it feels that while it's a new construction building and you're not faking that it's historic, that it doesn't call a lot of attention to itself. So it is a little higher style, so I have a slight concern about that, but I think ultimately the intention is to be very cognizant and complementary to the Tudor revival styles that you see prevalent in that Miles Manor neighborhood. I did note that stone construction is definitely one that we take seriously. We would like to see a sample of the stone so that we would have a better sense of the color intent, the profile, how that relates to historic stone in the neighborhood. The dormers are not typical of what we'd recommend currently in the design guidelines, but because it is so typical to the style that the applicant's proposing, I would support that on the front elevation, having dormers that sit on the wall as opposed to sitting on the roof. I feel like the style has been executed very nicely. I think the revisions to the entry are treated nicely. I understand that the applicant's a little disappointed with that, but I'm glad that they had that conversation so that we can show that to you now. The only other comments that I really had were about the garage and those windows at the rear. So Michael's covered that pretty clearly, and I'd love to hear your feedback on that. But the important thing for, you know, this neighborhood is to ensure that this blends in with the character and the materials very soundly. I know we haven't seen what's proposed next door. I have had a conversation with that architect as well as Ms. McNeely, and I believe that, you know, you were able to see the flyby that had that image in there. That image is based on information that the architect, Mr. Harbison, provided to Michael. So that gives you a sense of that form that you see drawn in is the intent for the applicant. Now, you have not commented on that. Yeah, you have not had the privilege to be able to speak to that quite yet, but I wanted to bring that to your attention so that you could see that the two architects are working closely together to try to have a streetscape that everyone could feel comfortable with.
And I haven't done justice to that design. It's a rough massing model. He also has another kind of piercing or protruding dormer that has another character of another swooping roof over that dormer, so that's going to work well with our home as well. As far as the stone material, the Andersons have selected a Tennessee gray limestone.
Thanks for bringing that.
And as far as the colors, we haven't really decided yet, but it's going to be either a dark gray or some kind of brown in the brown family.
For the siding?
For the siding. So it's going to be a contrasting color.
Okay. So what we're looking for today, and then I'll turn it over to the chair, is comments on the style itself, and specifically the more unique fenestration, meaning like specifically the windows placement, the window sizing in certain areas of the home. And then if you could also do the same for the rear, I think that would be helpful for zoning. Thank you.
Okay. Comments from the folks all around the table here.
I'll
Mary,
go first.
Go ahead.
Does the chimney die into the house form?
It does.
That would be one of my questions.
Otherwise, it will have a gap between the back of the chimney and the house.
Okay.
So yes, it does.
It has to die.
On both versions. If you flip to that side elevation, you can see how that's treated. You zoom in to a little closer right there, that chimney. Very good question. So that chimney goes all the way, and then when it pierces that that cornice, it is a little bit away from the house.
Okay.
So I want to make sure I'm clear on that. Will there be an offset at the base of the chimney where it sticks out from the flat facade wall, or no?
No.
Okay.
Is that what you meant, left to right or front to back?
I think she meant.
I'm just trying to visualize that chimney.
And I think I think that's a really good point to bring up.
It's flat into the facade.
Yes, that chimney is flush with the stone below, so that chimney is piercing.
Okay, but there's going to be some trim come across the front of it. Is that right?
No, ma'am. It's going to stop at the top of the intersection of the roof,
uh-huh.
And then it's going to start again at the bottom. We'll have a scupper at the top of that intersection right there, and it's going to come out about 4 or 5 inches, so that water, it's not going to come down the wall, but it's going to come away from the building as well.
That's something that I don't know what I need to see, but...
Should we see the 3D model or the 3D view,
yeah,
perhaps?
Yeah, we could do that. I love that. I love the way that showed it in the context of the neighborhood.
Okay, just a moment.
And then on the arbor... On the side.
Yes, ma'am.
Is there any access to that from the interior?
Yes, it is.
Okay. That was another question.
It's a good
like
stopping.
It's like a portico shape.
Mm-hmm. We don't want to call it a portico shape because it really isn't.
It isn't, but it's a... but I couldn't see it on...
It functions.
I couldn't
like
tell
one.
On mine.
Yes. It does have a friend's entry,
mm-hmm.
that accesses the mudroom.
Does the wall on the left... The wall that's under the chimney, does that have to be wider than the piece on the right? Is there a reason, probably?
It is. It's to form that mass of that gable. Otherwise, it will be almost, that gable will be almost symmetrical. And especially when we see the new version with the front door,
mm-hmm.
It definitely needs to be there.
Yes, just keep in mind this is a proposal that's just slightly different than that we're
I think
about
it's
going
to look completely different in stone and wood, so it's a, you know.
Right. This is just a quick mass
right.
study. I didn't do the fenestrations or the finishes to it. We just.
Yeah, I think if you try to see it all in stone, it makes all the glass in the front a bit softer. Than just mm-hmm. seeing white
right.
and dark.
Yes. Yep.
Mm-hmm. And Michael, can you clarify that the everything under the gable here is proposed to be stone, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
And I do want to note that, you know, I don't want there to be perception of treating things any differently from chimney to chimney. The reason I didn't call any attention to the fact that this is not extruded is because it's very typical of the architectural style to have a chimney that dies into the house like this. So the previous application that we reviewed, where I made that point, it wasn't as typical for that style.
Ms. Rose, can you speak to the staff's position on the size of that front window in the grand foyer? How, to me, that reads very large.
That is one reason I asked for the committee members to make those comments specifically, because it is not as typical to the neighborhood, and it's not as typical to a true historic structure to have this much glazing in this this pattern. I do think that, you know, removing the top row could be more in keeping with what you may see for this style elsewhere. It is very, very challenging because this is a new building, but it's also challenging because it is a slightly different style from some of the other buildings on the street. So we've got to be very sensitive to that. I understand the applicant's desire for this much glazing. I totally envision that for their interior and respect that. But to your point, Mr. Denton, it may be that it's a little too removed from what you see elsewhere on the street, to the point it might draw more attention to this building.
Is that the high style comment or the characterization, the high style?
Yeah, it's very it's pretty. It's a little higher style than some of the Tudors you see.
Well, as a storybook cottage, and as your design, I like it. It's a very nice design.
I
do have reservations about how it traditionally transitions into that neighborhood. So that's a reservation that I do have. And I would like to get staff's comment more on the wall dormer. I know on a historic addition that we usually don't support wall dormers, but this being infill, what is the normal way we view a wall dormer on infill?
Brian, can I ask if you mean specifically for the front elevation or?
The front elevation.
Front elevation. Okay, so I had mentioned previously that, you know, this dormer is not typical to what we would normally review and recommend, because we recommend roof placement for dormers instead of dying into the wall. Because that's so indicative of this particular architectural style, I do think it could be supported if the commission supports the architectural style. To Mr. Denton's point, I do think that there could be some revisions that are made to tone down the architectural style so that it's a little bit more sensitive to the surrounding neighborhood. But I agree, it's a fantastic design of this particular style. It just may need a little bit of finesse to get it to meet all the applicable guidelines.
But the Ken is sitting over here putting stone on it after making comments. If it has stone on it, it change.
It will.
Yeah, it calms it. You know, it is high style, but the stone makes it grounded.
It does. And I think that that's something that we would encourage the applicant to provide more visuals for during the formal application.
Can we look at the 3D renderings of my submittal?
Mm-hmm.
Can you see the stone pattern on that facade? Can you zoom in a little closer, perhaps, Amanda?
Yes. If I look here.
And the stone is more of a horizontal configuration.
So you can see that stone veneer or that stone wrapping around the entirety of the house, other than the second floor wing to the left of the gable.
And I think if you could see some more of that, like in the elevations, if they
give us an example of the portion of the stone.
I do have all four elevations on all.
Did you look?
You can scroll down.
Okay.
There's.
It helps give weight to the mass.
Sure. I understand.
And then the relationship of that towards the window, like the big window in the front, which I think is charming as is. And I think if we see what it would really look like with some of that stone facade. It would help maybe convince me to support a larger window versus a smaller window just for massing purposes.
Yeah, here's another image from the opposite corner as you're coming down the hill on Winslow. Obviously, the front door has been revised from that image, but you can see the stone massing of that front gable with a...
I'm just looking at what you handed out to me, so that's not in this little packet.
No, it was that was in the original package.
So in the interest of time and the applicant, can we get some feedback?
Well, let me ask a question. We hadn't talked about that lot to the left of it slopes greatly. What about the drainage issues that you have there, or how are you going to mitigate that?
Well, we'll have a permeable paver system, so all that water that's coming from our roof will go underneath that.
I'm talking about the lot next to you.
And then next door, their driveway will be adjacent to ours, and we'll do some kind of swell to move that water away.
That's a pretty good drop there. Would you like to comment, Mr. Anderson? Well, you have to come up here to the mic.
Yes.
And actually, on that 3D model, you can see how it drops. And actually, on that 3D model, I had placed that house too close to the Anderson's house. So.
Just push the button there, Danny, when you...
Mr. Chairman, I was just going to say the builder, Doug Majors, had the city to come out to look at that lot before we bought it. And he assures us there won't be an issue. Now, I'm proposing that we do a rain garden. We're going to try to work that out, which we had on our previous house that worked wonderful.
Okay.
It helps that Doug is building both homes probably at the same time. Well, maybe this ahead of 115.
And I will say to the rest of the commission, I understand what you go through and respect it, because I served on the commission for 6 years and then decided it was time to get off. But I do understand, and I hope some of you know that Teresa and I love this community, and we would never want to do anything that wasn't appropriate and that wasn't pretty.
I know it's going to be grand when it's done, whatever is done.
Yeah.
We hope.
Yeah.
But thank you.
Thank you. And you got the same rate of pay that we get, too, when you served, right?
We got the same pay.
These are just my comments. The size of the window, I agree that the front window is larger than what would be consistent with the neighborhood. I agree that the portraying it with the stone simile would be something that would mitigate the size of it, but I still think that it would be too large in relation to the other homes there. So that's one thing. And then the piece on the back, the window that you have back there with the awning, I'm not sure if that's typical of the area. So those would be my only comments.
I don't think that's typical of any area.
Ms. Markhart, can you just so I'm clear, can you explain where
that piece on the left? Yes.
Right here?
Yes.
For the garage?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the garage.
So that's not the garage. That's part of the garage, part of the carriage house. It is an art studio, so we wanted to fill that area with natural light.
Sure.
So and that will face the pool as well. You can see the dash line for the pool and overlooking that pool deck as well. So yes, it is atypical.
Yeah.
But it is atypical.
Yeah. Well, and I understand that the reason why you would want a lot of light to come into a studio. I'm just saying that's not under our purview to take that into consideration, and it may be inconsistent with the other properties there.
Ms. Rose, could you humor me with a street view of Winslow Drive from Franklin Road kind of to this site and look to see what's on each side as you, in that view shed?
Actually, I sent you a little drive-by that I did as well. Just on one side, not on the other side.
Well, I appreciated the application that showed it 3D.
That was helpful.
Yeah, just kind of go down the street and just see what other homes are on that street and their styling.
We have a lot of English influence, certainly.
And you can see that several of the houses have that side door. Oh, that's the reason we did that.
Yep. On to the left on the 111 Winslow, so you see that scrolled gable rake, so mm-hmm. try to replicate that, that kind of dormer that pierces that roof, replicating that on 119 as well. This house to the right here, that door doesn't face the front, it's to the side.
So I'll just comment a little bit more. I understand why the applicant requested the entry to be the way that it's requested. I certainly respect that. This is not a context deliberation at this point. The zoning administrators made a decision based on the zoning regulations in the ordinance. Yeah, and so the entrance has to be on the front.
Yeah, we're beyond that.
Amanda, can you
show? Well, you keep bringing it up. So I just want the commission to understand that we can't
Right.
We can't supersede that.
No, absolutely.
Amanda, can you show the houses that will be to the right of ours?
These guys right here?
Those.
Yeah, these bad boys here. So these are infill, clearly from, I believe, the 90s. Is that correct?
Yeah.
That was before, I think, there was...
Yeah, historic zoning was put in place on the Franklin Road around 2008, mm-hmm. 2006.
Mm-hmm.
So this goes on into Miles Manor Court, which has a lot of the similar, mm-hmm. English charm.
So seeing these brought up another question, and it regards height. So what is the height of this structure, and how does that relate to the block face?
To the which face?
To the other house.
Other homes along that side of the street.
Okay, on 119, on 111 Winslow, the existing stone house, it is 21.6. I think it's 21.6 or 22 feet.
Okay.
To the ridge, from finished grade to the ridge. 115, based on the architect's design, it's going to be about 34, 35 feet.
So you're under it.
Well, it's. That's the applicant's request. That hasn't come forward yet, so that's for the commission to decide.
And ours is at 30 feet from grade to the top of the ridge, upper ridge.
I do think that's a great question to ask, Brian.
It is.
And I didn't spend a lot of time evaluating percentages. I didn't have that information. We'll ask the applicant to provide that at the application stage, but. Given that the street falls pretty significantly, let me pull that street view back up. I do think that the streetscape that the applicant provided, that three-dimensional streetscape, shows that it will settle nicely. It's a 1.5 story scale here. I don't think, given what's on the right side of it, and what's sitting much higher here, that it'll have bring a lot of competition.
So how does it compare to the first new infill house?
It's going to be about to our left. To
that yellow one.
Yellow one, right down the screen.
Uh-huh. Like half the height.
That would be good.
Considerably lower. Okay, maybe about 10 feet
That would be good information when you come to historic zoning.
That's probably more than 10, yeah, I would agree.
Okay.
Yeah. We do have that 3D rendering. We pulled that information from Google Maps, and we can measure it.
Yeah.
You can see where that ridge is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's pretty accurate.
Mm-hmm.
For my feedback, I did notice the stone in the original submittal and looked at that, and I think it's really a beautiful. I feel like that window reads really big for that neighborhood, the front window, and I understand why you all want it from an interior perspective, but that does give me pause. And then the windows on the back of the carriage house, I think, and I understand why you want that as well, but from this accessory building, you know, you heard the discussion we had earlier about this addition on a garage that's pretty well hidden in downtown, and changing those, you know, suggesting potentially changing those from 3 to 1 to have it more, look more like a garage. I think that that big bank of windows on the back of that does give me some pause as well.
Would you be in favor of eliminating the transoms to the back and still keeping the 3 windows? Would that be a consideration?
Say that again.
Would eliminating the 3 transoms that are above that window, keeping the 3 windows low and just eliminating those transoms, and at the door on the opposite side of that carriage house, if we eliminate those transoms above the door and bringing down that shed roof, go up there. It will be on your left elevation. No, up a sheet. One more. That's the rear elevation. The left side towards the back of the carriage house.
Yeah.
That's the right side.
Oh, sorry. I promise I know left and right.
That's the right side. There, yeah, there you go, right there. If we eliminate those transoms above that front, those French doors, move down that shed roof, we'll have a large mass above that shed roof, but we can add a louver or something to dress up that empty gable up there without the transoms and without the shed roof. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
would you be?
I think that might help.
I think that would be helpful. Mm-hmm. And then
above the windows. What is that thing?
Transom. Yeah.
Okay. But the windows don't bother me as much as the projection out over the windows. That just.
You mean that shed roof?
The shed. Thank you. I couldn't think of it.
It serves a couple.
I mean, I understand why it's there, but I just.
Yeah. It's to protect the door. No matter how well that door is built, we'll have some water.
What if the shed were moved down over the door and then there was a big window above it?
That's what I'm. Well, it won't be inside that room.
Oh.
Well, maybe we can't put it. Yeah, we could put it because we're vaulting that space. We could.
It'd be worth looking at.
We could do that.
That's
absolutely.
And dropping your shed will afford more protection to those doors.
Yes.
Yep.
Where it is now.
Good point.
No, with the driving way.
Good point.
Good, very good point.
Because you don't have space above that.
I'm sorry?
You don't have space above that. You don't have finished space above that.
No. It's
art studio space.
No. It's vaulting front to back.
I want to note that this elevation would probably be not highly visible to anyone except the people living in the property. So I would encourage you to focus your comments on that rear elevation as requested by zoning to provide some guidance on if I can find it.
Last one more.
Okay. On these windows here.
And that's the rear.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you suggested removing those transoms.
Yeah, whatever we do to the back, we're going to do to the side because they're in the same room. I want to keep that alignment. So inside that room. So.
Yeah.
But if you move that shed roof down and those windows up, then you wouldn't have an opportunity to align with those on the side.
No, those transoms. Three transoms will be eliminated. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Michael, can you comment on how this window works? Because it appears to be sitting not encased in
it's like a dormer, so it's 1 foot behind the main facade. It's above a sink in the kitchenette upstairs.
Okay.
So that will break, or that piercing or penetrating on that portion of the roof. It's almost flat. We'll have a rubber membrane or a metal standing seam metal roof shading that roof.
So the side it projects outward. So there'll be siding on the other side of each window.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Well, the sill has a low slope roof that comes out to the eave.
Right. Okay. So, are there any other comments? I'd love to recap. So we get out here at the time that we
recap
before the ball games are.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So we did great on time, and we took some of the time for what would have been the last item for this one, but I think it was worth it. The comments that I've heard, and please let me know if I've left anything out, is that there are a few commission members, not everyone, that has some concerns about the front elevation fenestration and how it relates to the neighborhood. And staff will agree that it is much more a larger window than you see elsewhere on that street. That some folks would recommend removing the top row of windows here. Some folks feel that it may be quote unquote toned down by the proposed masonry, so it doesn't feel as front and center as it might otherwise. I received comments that, you know, the style itself is as a storybook, it is a little bit more pronounced than you see on the street, so making those changes would be a little bit more comfortable to the context of the neighborhood. This elevations change, so you know, just to say that the front door facing the front with the steps there is supported. The dormer here is supported based on the architectural style. There were no comments on the trellis, other than that there be an in and out, you know, opportunity at that location, which there is. This was a window, and the applicant changed that at my request, so I do want to thank them for that. That the accessory structure might need to lose some windows as well to be a little bit more historically typical of what you would see. So that may be removing these and lowering this shed awning or some other treatment that would be a little bit more typical. So we'll leave that to the applicant to bring something forward there. And then the rear elevation is likely to need to have some windows removed to be more historically typical as well. We do take context into account what you see from the street, but what transitional features is something we feel strongly about trying to maintain and encourage, because that affects everyone's comfortability with, you know, new development in neighborhoods. So as if we can be good neighbors and meet those requirements, that would be the best that we could do there. I do want to say this seems a little tall, but I think it could be lowered if these windows are removed. So I would encourage the applicant to kind of look at that as well.
We really can't, because it connects to the house. If you look at that breezeway to the opposite side, go one more.
I can see it here.
Oh, well, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Did I miss anything? Okay, we thank you all so much for coming in. I know it's been a long meeting for all of you, applicant included, so I hope this was helpful, and I'll be in touch with next steps for you.
Thank you, Amanda.
Thank you,
Victoria. Thank you.
Very nice class.
Thank you.
Gorgeous house.
Okay, I guess we're, Amanda, unless you've got something else, we're dismissed, huh?
I don't want to burden you with anything else, no.
All right. Thank you all.